Olympic Stadium, Rome. Yesterday's opening ceremonies, 138 strong, the United States, the largest contingent of athletes in these world championships of track and field. Among them seeking to regain his title, world's fastest human, Olympic champion Carl Lewis, who ran an eye-opening first heat yesterday.
Carl Lewis is in lane 7. Lewis is out of the blocks. Not that good a start. This is the first round, heat 6, men's 100. Lewis shifts gears. Carl Lewis moving out in front. Carl Lewis slowing up just a bit still. A 10.05, a record for Carl Lewis.
Lewis is ready, and so was Werner Gunter, captured one of the three titles yesterday. With the Italian crowd rooting for their own second place finisher, Andre Gunter gave an in-your-face answer. 72 feet, 11 and a quarter, the gold to the giant Swiss star. The 10,000 meters captured by Paul Kipkoech, 24-year-old Kenyan. It was a brilliant race, as was the marathon run authored by 99-pound Rosa Moda, Portugal, running proof that tremendous power and endurance can be hidden inside such small packages. Moda, the third gold winner by over 7 minutes. Today in Rome, the emphasis on speed. 100-meter finals for women features Heike Drechsler of East Germany. Some say she's on the verge of greatness. Some favor Merlene Ottey, the 27-year-old veteran from Jamaica. She won the bronze in the 84 Olympics 100. Both will have their eyes on Silke Gladisch of East Germany. But the race is the men's 100-meter, featuring the world's number one, Ben Johnson of Canada. Lightning out of the blocks, best time ever non-altitude against Carl Lewis of the United States. Lewis, the sprint star of the 84 Olympics, especially brilliant in the last half of the 100 meters, trying to regain the title fastest in the world. The answer could be a world record today in Rome. St. Peter's Cathedral, magnificent in the eternal city, Rome. It's a clear, sunny, hot August Sunday afternoon for day two of the World Championships of Track and Field. Hello, everyone. Welcome to Olympic Stadium. The excitement building as five more gold medals will be earned in the competition today. The women's high jump, the men's javelin, Americans with a chance to medal and an outside chance for a gold. An Italian is favored to win the 20-kilometer walk. That should make it exciting here in Olympic Stadium. The 100 meters for women, Ottey of Jamaica against Drechsler and Gladisch of East Germany. Diane Williams of the U.S. a chance to medal. But the story of this day is, who is fastest in the world? Is it Carl Lewis of the United States or Canadian Ben Johnson? We talked about St. Peter's. It took them 120 years to construct the world's largest cathedral. Well, in 10 seconds today, we'll learn who is fastest in the world. Johnson, strong, fast starter. Lewis, lanky and long with that great kick at the finish. It is a track and field aficionado's dream. Who is fastest? The two fastest men of this decade will duel on this Olympic track today, and the man who'll call it for you is Charlie Jones.
Dick, you are so right. This is one of those special days in the world of sports. When you wake up in the morning, you can hardly wait for 4:30 in the afternoon for the semifinals of the 100 meters. And Frank Shorter, it is a brilliant, sunshiny day here in Rome.
Charlie, once every 10 to 20 years in track and field in an event, in this case the 100 meters, you find two athletes at the peak of their form, ready to set world records, both chasing those records, competing on the same day.
And also they've been kind of taunting each other in the early rounds.
In the early rounds, they have been running world record times and then backing off in the last 10 meters, almost as if they're teasing us and taunting each other.
Ben Johnson, an explosive start that we have seen, and that's something to look forward to. Now let's go back to Carl Lewis. In the first round, he was simply brilliant.
Carl ran the perfect race for 90 meters and then backed off. For him, he had a very good start. He got out very quickly. In the middle of the race, he's second from the left. He accelerates the way only Carl Lewis can do from 20 to 80 meters. Look at that acceleration. And then backs off through the tape and still sets a record.
It's a championship record. Officially, it is 10:05, but he was backing off the last 15 to 20 meters. No question about that.
Well, I think there's a good psychological advantage to backing off. You feel you are mentally saving it for the final, and these people are hot dogs to a certain degree. They like to see the opposition notice what they're doing.
And Missy Kane, what about the women's 100?
I think you could beat very fast and just as exciting as the men. We could see close to a world record. One of the clear favorites is Heike Drechsler. She's East Germany's golden girl. Here she says she's going for 4 gold medals. Kind of sounds like Carl Lewis back in the 84 games. But she's going to have to beat a teammate of hers, Silke Gladisch. Now, Silke already beat Heike this year twice, so that's going to be interesting. And one good note is that all three Americans made it through yesterday, and all three hope to make that final.
Now let's go down to Dwight Stones.
The races will belong to the swift, but the focus on the field will be on the strong and agile as we cover the men's javelin throw and the women's high jump today. Joining me will be Larry Rawson. And Larry, quite a contrast in the two field events today.
Well, it is, Dwight. Brute strength predominates in the javelin. And we have two top Americans there, the winner of our TAC championships, Duncan Atwood, and also Tom Petronoff, the former American record holder with the old javelin and also with the new. The finesse and style will be shown by the women's high jump final. The world record holder, Stefka Kostadinova of Bulgaria, is in it, but so isn't a woman who's had some success defeating her, American Louise Ritter. Colleen Summer, who is a former world indoor record holder, will be competing also. Dwight, it should be a fine field event day.
Absolutely, and also some surprises from this morning's men's triple jump and women's discus qualifying. But now, back up to the booth and Charlie Jones.
We're ready now for the first of two semifinals, men's 100 meters, the world record held by Calvin Smith of 9.93. In the first heat, Andreas Berger in lane one from Austria. Alexander Yevgeniev of the Soviet Union in two. Lee McRae of the United States is in three. Eric Akwajikam from Ghana is in four. Pierre Francesco Pavoni of Italy is in five. Ben Johnson of Canada is in six. Linford Christie of Great Britain is in seven. And Andrew Smith of Jamaica is in lane eight. In lane six on the right, that is Ben Johnson. And next to him on the left is Linford Christie of Great Britain.
Charlie, watch Ben Johnson start. It's unique and novel in the world of track and field. He doesn't step out and rise up slowly. He literally jumps up on both feet when he starts. He feels this makes him much, much faster. And it seems to work because he's the favorite in this event, not Carl Lewis.
Carl Lewis is running in the second semifinal. This is the first. Top four finishers will move through to the final later today. And it's a fair start, and Ben Johnson gets a great start, and Johnson is way out in front. Johnson pulling away, and remember, this is the semifinals. Now he'll coast down. Linford Christie will come on to finish second, and the roar of the crowd tells you that it looks as if Pier Francesco Pavoni of Italy will be in the top four and will move through to the finals. Ben Johnson, an awesome display in the semifinals.
Ben Johnson's start was the fastest I've seen in this competition. Lee McRae in lane three is supposed to be the fastest starter in the world, but I think Ben Johnson, with his new start, he may be the fastest out of the blocks. Pavoni from Italy seemed to be hurt coming through, maybe pulled something. He qualified, but he's in trouble because he's got to come back in just a little bit of time and try to run in the finals. He's not faking it here.
An unofficial 10-16 into a slight headwind. And, of course, as you can see at the end of this, Ben Johnson coasting in. Look at
Watch
that leaping start.
Just pop up, and he's up running. Contrary to all track and field theory, he's found a new start, and it works for him. He backs off. That was a 10 flat 100, if anything.
It's Johnson, Christie, and then Pavoni.
Watch Ben Johnson hop up. He pulls up his hands and just, boom, springs up. Look at that. And he is out of there. Boy, if he can keep that start in the finals, we're going to see quite a race. Ben Johnson, and again, very well coached. This is coaching that does this. He's got tons of talent, but he's also well coached.
And it's going to be a photo for fourth place. Lee McRae may be in there. We'll have to wait and see.
So, number one in the world, Ben Johnson cruises into the finals. We'll be back with the answer from Carl Lewis in his semi.
Ready ready for the second semifinal men's 100 meters. Here are the lane assignments. Kovacs is in one. McFarland is in two. Raymond Stewart of Jamaica is in three. Simone of Cuba is in four. Victor Bresgen of the Soviet Union is in five. Chidi Imo of Nigeria is in six. Antonatsov of Bulgaria in seven. And the great Carl Lewis is in lane eight. The world record, Calvin Smith's 9.93. Carl Lewis in the first round running so well, it was an official 10.05, and that's a championship record, but he was pulling up at the end. He might have had a world record.
Not only that, Charlie, it was at sea level, and the world current world record was set at altitude where it is easier to run. The air is thinner.
That black ribbon, of course, on his shirt in honor of his father who passed away this spring. Carl Lewis in lane eight, top four finishers through to the final. And here's Lewis with a good start, but not a great start. And here comes Carl Lewis in lane eight. And Lewis is going to have to battle his way. Now he pulls out in front, and he crosses the finish line first with Raymond Stewart of Jamaica coming through behind him. And a 10.03. If that holds, he has another championship record, and he was coasting again.
Charlie, this race was deceptive because it was a great field. Raymond Stewart from Jamaica on the yellow in the right runs very well. Carl Lewis gets into gear about 50 meters out, motors in. It looks like he's having a more difficult time, but that's because Stewart is running well too. Carl Lewis, 10.03. We may see a world record in the final. Carl Lewis does not have the world's greatest start. He more gets out even. So in the final, he's going to have some trouble with Ben Johnson out of the blocks. But once he gets going, no one goes as fast as Carl Lewis. Look at this acceleration right there. Puts it in another gear. He has a gear above everybody else. And again, doesn't ease through this time. He wants to get to the final, 10.03.
And from the front, Carlos, watch. Aerodynamically, his hands are the finest in the business. Notice what he does with them. And he does that slicing through the air without tightening up his arms and his shoulders. I had a feeling, though, he was coasting just a bit at the end.
I think he had to wait a little longer than he did in his previous races, but he did coast a little bit at the end here. Still, it's almost like he doesn't want to run all out until the final.
Unofficial, 10.03 into a slight headwind.
Oh, my, and what a final field of eight. McRae joins Carl Lewis at the United States. As you know, Mark Witherspoon, the third American, eliminated in the first round yesterday. Pavoni gives the Italian someone to cheer about. Ben Johnson, apparently the world record holder in high gear with a tremendous start. Christie of Great Britain is a threat. Kovac, Stewart, the young Jamaican, and Brishkin, the Soviet. You heard Frank Shorter talk about how impressed he was with the start of Johnson, as everyone around the world that has watched him has been. How fast is Johnson out of the blocks? How quickly does he react? We had a clock on that. Here is the gun reaction time of the two men that are competing for the world record and the gold medal here in the World Championships. Johnson, 127 thousandths of a second. He reacts and is out of the blocks. Lewis almost twice as slow, if you can call 212 thousandths of a second slow. So Johnson, obviously, the advantage there. But as you saw, Lewis able in those last 50 meters to really get into overdrive. Well, Carl Lewis had a special rooter in the stands here at the Olympic Stadium in Rome. His sister, Carol, a long jumper for the United States in Helsinki, in fact, in 83. And here's Carol and her reaction. Didn't like his start, but she sure liked the finish and tried to get his attention. But Lewis is really focused. He was on his way down the tunnel with tunnel vision. He's ready now for the finals, just a couple hours away. Next up, here in Rome, Louise Ritter, American's top choice and chance for a medal in the high jump. Louise Ritter goes in her event as we continue our activities. Day two of the World Track and Field Championships from the Eternal City, Rome. The Olympic high jump for women was won by the great Yolanda Balish of Romania at 6 feet 3/4 of an inch, the first time a woman had ever jumped over 6 feet in the Olympics. They had to jump over 6'2 just to be qualifiers for the finals here in Rome for these world championships. And the world record holder is a 22-year-old Bulgarian, Stefka Kostadinova. And she has jumped 6'9 3/4, and definitely the one to beat. We'll meet her now.
Strolling through the streets with her coach, high jumper Stefka Kostadinova reflects on her training. The world indoor champion has had a long season of competition. This year's world championships falls at the end of an already successful year. I asked Stefka how she thinks this lengthy competitive season has affected her preparations for Rome.
My coach has told me that to compete often is the only way to deal with the lateness of the World Championships. I feel better prepared because of the many competitions I've had this year, but of course this also gives my competitors a little more time.
The world record holder has raised the level of performance in the women's high jump and challenged the other competitors to keep up with the example that she has set in the event.
Dwight, you know as well as I do that being number one means that there's always someone who wants to take your place. The level of competition is rising and many other girls are jumping 2 meters or more. You'll see 2 meters 12 soon in the women's high jump.
While the men close in on an 8-foot jump, the women look at 7 feet as the barrier to break. Is Stefka capable of becoming the first woman to clear 7 feet?
My coach and I think about this all the time, and he thinks that I may be the one to do it. I can't say I believe it 100%, but I hope that perhaps with the proper training and a little bit of luck, I may be among those who can do it.
Louise Ritter in her first attempt at 6 feet 4 inches. Dwight, this 29-year-old American has had an outstanding season during July and August in Europe. She lays out pretty cleanly at 6 feet 4. Actually, not a very severe height for her to attempt. She's been up to 6'7" this season.
That's why I was surprised when she had a miss early at 6'2 and 3 quarters, but it looks like she made the adjustment and she's okay.
Has the wind been a factor today?
No doubt about it. It's been swirling, it's in the face, it's at the tail, and then you have to really adjust where your takeoff point's gonna be, how much speed you can use to the bar, and I think that's bothering a lot of the girls.
Well, here's a woman who might be troubled here. 6 feet four is just about as high as she has cleared this year. She's been up to 6'5". This is Colleen Summer from the United States attempting 6 feet four. This is her third and final attempt.
Very easy clearance. She made a little stutter step a few feet before the bar, and that's because of the wind. They can feel themselves coming in too fast, maybe a little bit too slow, and they make the adjustment.
Dwight, as we look at the picture, the wind's been coming from the right part of the stadium to the left. Would that have helped her in that jump since she jumps off her right foot?
Absolutely. There's no doubt about it. But she's over that. She looks as though she's adjusted to it, and now it's just a matter of getting very, very comfortable. We'll be right back after this.
And Bulgaria and Louise Ritter, much easier to say, are through easily in the early rounds, so the high jump will rejoin that action. Now to the women's 100-meter semis, and this semi, Merlene Ottey of Jamaica, one to watch. Soka Gladisch, the up-and-coming East German, Alice Brown and Pam Marshall are the top Americans, top four to the finals later today. Charlie?
Women's 100 meters, this is the first semifinal. Top four finishers will move through to the finals. World record is held by Evelyn Ashford with a 10.76. Evelyn injured and not in the field. Lane assignments. Savary is in lane one from West Germany. Slusar of the Soviet Union. Pam Marshall of the United States is in three. Silke Gladisch of East Germany is in four. Merlene Ottey of Jamaica is in five. Isayenko of Canada is in six, and she really looked good in the trials. Georgieva of Bulgaria is in seven. Alice Brown, with a great star of the United States, is in lane eight. That's Silke Gladisch in four on the right. Merlene Ottey in five, right in the middle of your picture. And Isayenko of Canada in lane six.
And Charlie, all three of these women have gone under 11 seconds in the 100 meter this year, and that's a barrier that athletes love to break. So all these three women are running very well. Ottey from Jamaica in the middle lane has been consistently under 11 seconds this year. She trains in America. She went to Nebraska. She lives in the United States, but she is Jamaican.
And it is Silke Gladisch with a great start. She just explodes out of the blocks in lane four. And it is Gladisch, and pulling along with her is Merlene Ottey and Isayenko. And it looks as if Pam Marshall in lane three may have finished in fourth and moved through to the finals.
Silke Gladisch seems like she just jumps out of the block right in the middle of your screen. Another key factor is that she has good body lean right there. You don't want to be straight up. You want your momentum to go forward. She has that all the way. Marlene's coming up slightly, but not enough to catch her at the finish line.
We'll take another look at Silke Gladisch.
On the right of your screen, she's out very quickly. She's a short girl with stocky legs. She can get into a running pattern much quicker than the taller Merlene Ottey in the middle there. Look at her arms. That's a key in sprinting. You've got to use your arms. She uses them very well. She's relaxed, even though she's sprinting all out. Her shoulders are down, and that helped her, I think, run such a good time here.
And her time, 10.82, a great time. It is, though, wind-aided, will not count, 2 meters, 0.12. So it is just above the allowable. We'll be back to the World Championships in Rome in a moment. This is the second semifinals, women's 100 meters. In lane one is Paula Dunn of Great Britain. Angela Bailey of Canada is in lane two. Heike Drechsler, one of the favorites, is in lane three. She's from East Germany. Diane Williams of the United States is in four. Anelia Nunova of Bulgaria is in five. Nellie Coleman of Holland is in six. Natalia Pomozhnikova of the Soviet Union is in seven. And Marlies Gurr of East Germany is in lane eight. Evelyn Ashford holds the world record of 10.76.
Let's watch Drechsler start on the far right. She's really been working on this, and she's gotten a lot faster out of the block. She has an unusual looking start.
Drechsler in lane three. Diane Williams is next to her in the United States in four. Nunova, Bulgaria is in five. And Drechsler gets a terrible start. She is left in the blocks. It is Diane Williams. And now coming outside is Nunova. And now here comes Heike Drechsler. And Drechsler coming off with a terrible start. Comes through to win the semifinal and move through.
Charlie, like I was saying earlier, she's got a new start, but you can tell she's all coiled down with her arms very bent here. That's unusual. But as we see here, she hesitates coming out of the blocks, and you cannot do that. Look how far back she is. Nunova in the middle of your screen with a red top and white shorts. So she led the world this year early in 10.86. She's out very quickly. But Diane Williams in between those two with all white on, she's making up some ground here. She had the bronze in Helsinki, but Heike Drechsler, she passes everybody the last 30 meters and looked wonderful. Here we see her on the right of your screen. She looks like she hesitated. I don't know if she thought it was a false start or what, but she was out slow. Nunova has a wonderful start. Here we go. Heike Drechsler gets into full gear right here. Good arm swing. She keeps her arms low. She's 5'11" tall, so she's very tall, but she gets going in the middle there. Very mechanical, but she also stays relaxed throughout the whole 100 meters, which is hard to do with that terrible start.
It looks as if Drechsler, along with Nunova, Angela Bailey and Diane Williams of the United States will move through to the finals.
And there are the finalists for the women's 100-meter dash later this afternoon. The Americans, Pam Marshall and Diane Williams. Williams perhaps with the best chance at a medal, but the race really is between three. Drechsler, Gladisch of East Germany, and Merlene Ottey of Jamaica. We wish that there was another name on that list, and it was Evelyn Ashford, who is injured, was going to run the 200 meters anyway here in Rome, I guess. Or were you thinking about maybe the 100 if you were healthy?
No, the 200 is what I qualify for.
Now, we just go back to that last race, if you will. We're talking about Ben Johnson and his explosive start, and the start obviously so critical in the dash. And Drechsler wins that last semifinal, despite the fact that she was 5 meters behind out of the block, seemed to have her head in a funny position.
Her start is unusual because she is so far, has all her weight on her arms, and she's trying to throw her body out of the starting blocks to have a better start. She is a long jumper trying to be a sprinter. She's doing a great job, but she needs more race experience.
She's obviously a great talent to be able to catch him and still win.
Obviously, she has great leg speed, and she's a tall sprinter, too. She's very tall for a sprinter.
Would I be anywhere near accurate if I compared her teammate Gladisch to Johnson in terms of she really seems to pop out of the blocks?
Okay, what Johnson does is he stands right up, and the other sprinters are doing their gradual acceleration, and he pops right up and goes right into his running phase, and that's what he's doing different. Gladisch is gradually accelerating, which is what we always do.
All right, now, if Johnson is that successful with that start, is that because he's just a special, unique person, or has he started something that others will try to emulate?
I think others will try to emulate it, but he is extremely strong. He has much more muscle mass than most of the other sprinters, and he's able to handle it. He's developed that style, I think, over the years because he has had this success, you know, some success with his style. Other sprinters will try it.
All right, let's go back to 83 in Helsinki. I know if we'd ask you, you didn't want to see this.
Do we have to?
This is the 100-meter finals in Helsinki, the first World Championship Games. That's Evelyn second from the right in the red, and it appeared she was on her way to gold when about the 40-meter mark you pulled up with a muscle pull. Is that the same injury that has kept you out of this competition?
No, that particular injury was my glute and my hamstring on the right leg. This one is a slight muscle strain on the left hamstring.
You can stick around because this is an exciting day, the 100 meters.
Yes, it is. I can't wait.
To be decided for the women and the men. Will be right back in Rome. Hot, sunny, and clear in this late afternoon in Rome, Italy. And tomorrow, a special birthday. One of our athletes will be 32 years young, Edwin Moses, the gold medal winner in the 400-meter hurdles in 76 and 84, the world champion in Helsinki in 83, 122 wins in a row until Danny Harris ended that streak in Madrid 3 months ago. He has dominated his sport, unlike many in any sport. Edwin Moses is the 400 hurdles. He owned that event for some 10 years. Moses has his first time on center stage today as we start the heats of the 400-meter hurdles, and many of the crowd here in Rome here to see that man.
This is round one of the men's 400-meter hurdles, heat number one. We will have the top two finishers moving through to the finals with the four best other times. It'll be a total of six heats. Lane one is open. Edwin Moses is in two. Gillingham is in three. Zimmerman is in four. Umiki is in five. Kiyomolari is in six. Kitor is in seven. And Yoshida is in eight. And, of course, all eyes will be on lane two. Edwin Moses, the world record holder with a 47.02, August the 31st, 1983, defending champion and two-time Olympic champion. He's in lane two. Again, lane one is open.
Edwin should have no trouble in this heat, but he's still fun to watch because he's the best hurdler in history. He just goes over the barriers so well.
And already he begins to close the stagger on Martin Gillingham of Great Britain, who is in lane three just to his right.
Charlie, unlike some of the flat races where in the early rounds athletes back off, you can't really do that so much in the hurdles because if you do, it throws your steps off. So you have to run fairly hard every race. So he'll win this by a whole bunch, not because he's hot-dogging, but because he has to. He doesn't want to throw himself off.
And again, the top two finishers will move through to the finals. Out in lane five from Nigeria is Henry Amike. And he is now drifting back to second place. And Edwin Moses will coast in, moving to the next round.
Edwin ran a low 48 race there. That's pretty fast for the early rounds. That would be the fourth or fifth best time in the world this year. But again, he has to run pretty fast because it's such a technical event.
And as you say, he's such a great athlete. It's fun to watch him in any race.
Watch his head as he goes over the hurdles. It probably will not go up very much. He chopped a little bit on his steps, but he's a fine hurdler. He just has such control over his body, right back into the same rhythm. You could play one piece of film on top of another, it wouldn't change. You can see he draws in a little bit, pulls up his lead leg, and just runs right over the hurdle. And that's what's so unique about Edwin. His legs are just about as long on the inseam as the hurdles are high, so he can literally step right over them. And he's got his timing down so much, he's got so much experience that this kind of trial really is easy for him. The only threat to him is if he hits a hurdle and falls down. Edwin coming down the home stretch, he's relaxed, he runs the same number of steps between each hurdle, they're all meted out, he runs the exact same distance on each stride, and he's just fun to watch because technically he's the best person that's ever been in this event.
An unofficial 49.03 for Edwin Moses.
We understand we're having some technical difficulties with the heat and the transcontinental transmission, trans-world transmission. We apologize for that, and we're correcting it, and hope you'll stay with us. A very big day this Sunday in Rome. Moses told us before the start of the competition he's never trained better for a big meet than this one, so that's a good sign for him. He feels good about himself coming into this competition. But we have some bad news, apparently, down in the high jump competition for the United States. We understand that some troubles there for our leading medal hope, Louise Ritter, as she tries to battle, repeat her bronze of Helsinki 4 years ago. Let's go to Dwight and Larry for the high jump.
Dick, right as you are, Louise Ritter up for her third attempt at 6 feet 5 inches. When we last were speaking to you, she had a very easy make at 6 feet 4 inches.
Dwight, she didn't look good on her earlier attempts either at this height. 6 feet 5, Louise, I'm sure, major disappointment and a big surprise for track and field fans.
Right here, you can see that she is bearing down so hard. This is so important to her. This is an intermediate height for Louise Ritter, the way she's been jumping this season. She hits it on the way up, extremely disappointed. She ends up in eighth place, not a fate that we would have expected from Louise Ritter.
Colleen Summer, America's last hope. This is her third and last attempt at 6 feet 5.
Larry, as you mentioned earlier, she's pretty much in over her head at 6 feet 5 this year. However, she had a better last attempt than did Louise. But those are our two American girls. They are out of the competition really before the competition has had a chance to heat up.
That's a good way to put it, Dwight. 6 feet 5 for the best in the world is really only the middle of a race before the sprint starts.
Exactly. As you can see here, she gets off the ground nicely, but with the wind and everything else, she hits the bar on her way down. This is Susanne Beyer of East Germany, who has been jumping extremely well just in the last couple of weeks inside of East Germany. She really hasn't had a lot of opportunities to compete outside of the country.
She was not rated among the top 50 high jumpers in the world last year. Here she is among the top 6 in the sport now.
Nice clearance at 6.6 1/4. That was her second attempt. She may be in the medal hunt with that particular attempt. That was a very fine jump.
Susanne Beyer over 6 feet 6 1/4 inches.
Very good control here, as do all the East Germans. Very nice height right on top of the bar.
And meanwhile, we understand that the Bulgarian Stefka Kostadinova is just jumping effortlessly. And we'll return to Rome after we pause for these words from your local station.
The men's 400-meter hurdles. Again, the top two finishers moving through to the finals with the four best other times. Edwin Moses holds the world record. He won the first heat and has moved through to the next round. In this heat, Van Baer is in lane 1. Max Robertson of Great Britain is in 2. Futterkanet is in 3. Skeya is in 4. Edgar Itt of West Germany is in 5. Ochako is in 6. Lane 7 is open, and Danny Harris is in lane 8. And as you know by now, Danny Harris is the man who ended the streak of Edwin Moses at 107. He also the Olympic silver medalist.
Danny Harris would be in a bit of trouble if this were the final, but since it's an early round, he's in lane 8, and as long as he runs in a relaxed fashion, he shouldn't have much trouble qualifying. We're at the final, he wouldn't be able to see anyone. Here, where the opposition really isn't that good, if he stays relaxed, just runs his race, he'll be fine.
Not only is he out in lane 8 where you cannot see anybody to pull on, lane 7 to his left is open. So in reality, the next runner is 2 staggers back in lane 6. And that's Ochako of Kenya. One of the ways when you're watching this to see who is leading, of course, is just to pick out like the third or fourth flight of hurdles and see whose leg goes up first going after it. And as you can see now, it is Danny Harris way outside who has the lead. But Max Robertson in lane 2 of Great Britain is also running very well, and he has closed his stagger on lane 3.
Oh, and Danny Harris had to chop his steps on that hurdle, so they're going to catch him a little bit. Robertson in lane 3 is the next best runner in this field on time.
Robertson, he's in lane 2, Frank.
Oh, lane 2.
And outside it is Danny Harris, and now you can see what Danny has done without anybody to pull on. This is basically a blind race, and he still is going to win it by close to 15 meters with Max Robertson of Great Britain coming in second in the heat in 48.73 unofficial. That is an excellent time. Very good for a heat time, particularly outside in lane 8 and all alone.
Danny Harris on the backstretch, running along. He chopped, I think it was the fifth hurdle, and that's what happens in the intermediate hurdles. If you don't run the exact same distance, the exact same number of steps in between the hurdles, you have to chop your steps. There, he chopped a little bit there, and maybe it's the next hurdle coming up. There, you can see him sort of stagger there. He had to pull back a little bit, and he still ran 48.73, which is very, very fast for this race. Can't hold back. He was running a little bit scared here, I think. He couldn't see anyone. In the stretch, he may look over a little bit, but he doesn't. He just looks for the finish line and runs right straight through. Maybe having to chop his steps on that fifth hurdle told him that he better run hard to the finish. He didn't know where anyone was, and he finally eases up to 48.73.
So the key qualifiers in the 400-meter hurdles, of course, Edwin Moses, the man to beat, and Danny Harris, the man who did just that, ending Moses' 122 victory streak. Harold Schmidt, still tough, the German. And down on the bottom, Amadou Diaba of Senegal might have a chance for a medal. We understand in the high jump, the defending champion from the Soviet Union, Bykova, is causing some problems. Let's go to Dwight.
Dick, you're absolutely right. Tamara Bykova has been flawless all the way through. This competition is matching stride for stride with Stefka Kostadinova. And Bykova over cleanly at 6'8 and a quarter, which is only 1 centimeter below her all-time personal record. She is coming completely out of the woodwork this year.
Dwight, she hasn't been up there in several years either.
She won the world championships in 83, dominated in 83, but since then has not been a factor. She makes 6'8 and a quarter cleanly. That puts a lot of pressure on Kostadinova, but she's been over this height many more times than any other woman in the world.
10 of the 13 highest jumps in history, and the high jump belonged to this woman. She attempts 6'8¼".
Not an impressive jump whatsoever. You would think that jumping behind Bykova and her, after her having such an impressive clearance, that Kostadinova would have to respond immediately, but that was a very poor attempt.
She has only one more jump at this height. That's her second miss. You're allowed 3 attempts at any given height.
Driving the turn very well, but she takes too long from her right foot to her plant foot and hits the bar on the way up. She's got her hands full. She goes down to her third attempt at 6'8¼". If she doesn't make it, she loses the gold medal. Unthinkable for Kostadinova.
Moments like this, this is not a team sport. Let's watch.
Response of a champion. Don't just make it, make it by a ton. Daylight under Stefka Kostadinova, but she knows she has her hands full. She's in second place. She must make the next height just to win, and we're getting into very rarefied air.
The world record holder, 6'9¾", she has cleared in the past.
Kostadinova able to keep her emotions in check. She knows what she must do. The sun in her face, she just nails it at the plant, very nice vertical, and makes that height with room to spare. That's what she needed.
Just 22 years of age, the Bulgarian, she started as a swimmer, said the water was too cold. Well, she's in a high altitude climate here in Rome. The world record holder at 6'9¾", under pressure from the defending champion, jumps and jumps with confidence. She shows maturity beyond her years. We'll continue with the competition from Rome after we pause for this.
Is at 6'9". This is the second attempt for Tamara Bykova, the defending champion from Helsinki in 1983. She is the leader on misses. And a very fine effort. She is jumping so well in this competition, a great big meet performer.
5 times, indoors and out, the world record holder. This is her main competition.
Kostadinova, second attempt at 6'9". And she's over.
Beautiful.
By
clear.
A mile. Back into the lead. Now she is winning the gold. Bykova must respond by jumping this height as well as the next.
Bykova has just one jump left. This is Kostadinova.
Incredible confidence. Going from the depths of despair to the top of the mountain. Stefka Kostadinova with room to spare at 6'9".
Her run up about 65 feet. This is the last attempt for Bykova.
Bykova has had the bar raised to 6'9¾" because she cannot win by jumping 6'9". She's going for it with one final attempt.
No, Not close. Not close.
It was not meant to be this time. I have to admire the courage of Bykova, though, having a phenomenal meet and going to tie the world record to win.
She defended her title like a champion should. 65 feet is her run-up.
She looked very good in the run-up, but she just didn't have any more. Missed it on the way up. But what a tremendous performance by Tamara Bykova.
So, Kostadinova now will go for her world record. Perhaps, we'll see. She is at 6.9 3/4 as the world record set earlier last year by her. Now to the 400 meters, Butch Reynolds from Ohio State. He's come out of nowhere and has run the three fastest times ever at sea level in the 400. The man to watch. Let's go to the main stadium.
First round of the men's 400 meters. The world record is 43.86, and that's one of the oldest on the books. Bruce Phillip. Butch Reynolds, United States. He, of course, one of the favorites. Skerritt, Hudik Stevens, Scherzing, Almaki, Milzer, and Takano. Butch Reynolds, not one of, he is the favorite.
He is the absolute favorite. He's running 2 3/10 of a second faster than anyone else in the world this year, which is a lot in the 400 meters.
And a new face. He really just, this year has been the year that he has come out.
And he's run very well. He's run a lot of races indoors and outdoors. The real question is, has he run too much in Europe?
This is the first round. The top four finishers at eight next best times in the heats will move through. Butch Reynolds, the United States, is in lane two as you look in the head-on shot.
And Butch has a tendency to start out slowly. He's not even in the picture here. He'll come into the picture in a minute. He tends to start slowly and then come on very strongly in the last straightaway.
And there he comes in lane two. Outside in lane eight, that's Takano of Japan.
And Butch Reynolds running comfortably on through to the next round.
So into the semifinals, and here are the key qualifiers. The Americans, of course, one of their strongest events. Reynolds, McKay, and Haley, all in search of a possible sweep for the U.S. Innocent Egbunike from Azusa Pacific. The Nigerian is a tough and has beaten Reynolds this year. Keter of Kenya, Schnobly of Germany. Redmond of Great Britain, and Cameron with a BERT, the Jamaican who was the winner in Helsinki 4 years ago. So the 400 meters, they all say they'd rather run something else. It's a real bear. Let's go back to the high jump.
Dick, this is the ultimate in the high jump, attempting a world record, 6 feet 10 1/4. She's already the world champion, Stefka Kostadinova's first attempt.
Ooh, good attempt though, Dwight, not a bad attempt.
She's had a lot of emotional distress today. She almost lost this competition and then won it, and now she's going for the world record. They've been out here a long time today, Larry.
Watch her jump. She uses her arms to lift up, rotates her body, uses his right arm to lay out for levity, but doesn't quite get her legs up and over.
She makes the adjustment on the step. She could make this height. She has the strength.
That's a new world indoor record for Stefka Kostadinova of Bulgaria, the 27-year-old young lady. What a great performance.
Unbelievable. 6.10 1/4. She just nicks it on the way down. This is the ultimate. A half an hour ago, she was staring at her final attempt at 6.8 1/4. She had to make it to win. And now a new world record, 6.10 1/4. She's got to love it.
Listen to the Italian crowd cheer and sing as though you're at an American college football game. Here she goes in the new world record.
Such a strong run-up, good arm swing. She works the turn so well, puts that plant down, just nicks it on the way down. Incredible performance.
50,000 people cheering here in Rome.
I'm not sure she's done jumping.
Now, wouldn't you say, we've seen this often over here in another competition, she's looking at her coach, maybe, for direction?
She may want just to take one more jump, just one jump at a higher height.
Look at her. Her reaction is like, you really want me to go higher?
Unbelievable. 6.10 1/4, a new world record for Stefka Kostadinova. Bykova gets the silver medal, and Susanna Beyer the bronze. Up to the studio, and Dick Enberg.
All right, Dwight Stones. So Kostadinova thrilling this huge crowd at Olympic Stadium, setting a world record in the world championships. And it's interesting to show how far that event has come and what Fosbury did with his flop for the sport. That jump by Kostadinova of 6.10 1/4 would have won every Olympic Games including the men, through the 1952 Olympics. And here it is again. We had one record in Helsinki, and Kostadinova on the second day has thrilled the track and field enthusiasts in Rome with a magnificent leap, 6:10 1/4. Brava.
This is Charlie Jones, along with Missy Kane and Frank Shorter. We're back in the brilliant sunshine of Rome at the World Championships of Track and Field. And Frank, still to come, the final in the men's 100 meters.
The semifinals didn't disappoint anyone. Ben Johnson showed that he's got the fastest start in the world. He's come up with a new start, won his heat very easily. Carl Lewis had more trouble in his heat, better competition, but he set another record in the semifinals. So the scene is set. The world's fastest human will be decided here.
And we also have set the scene for the women's finals in the 100 meters.
Just like in the men's race, we saw someone explode out of the blocks, and that was Silke Gladisch. She ran 10:82. That's close to a world record right there. Now, Heike Drechsler is picked in this race. She had a terrible start, but she still ran 10:95. And the Americans, two of the Americans did make it to the final, so that's going to be a fast one.
One of the nice things about this assignment is the fact that we've been in Rome for a week and looking forward to the marathon next Sunday. Frank, you've had an opportunity to run the marathon course.
And it's a wonderful course. I like to run wherever I travel, and here it's great because the Colosseum, the Circus Maximus, the Roman Forum, they're all close together, and the athletes in the marathon will be passing these historic sites many times. I think I'm going to go back and take a closer look.
All right. But first things first, we have some historic sites here at Olympic Stadium, and next up, Missy Kane, the semifinals in the women's 400 meters.
Charlie, the 400 meters has always been dominated by East Germans. Now, Marita Koch holds the world record, but she's retired. But believe me, they have plenty of newcomers coming up. Also, some of the Americans are really picked to do well here. Lily Leatherwood King has broken 50 seconds this year. That's a real barrier to break. She's picked a medal. We hope to see that.
Women's 400 meters. Marita Koch holds the world record, 47:60. Charmaine Crooks, Forgatch, Petra Mueller, Brisgina, Denine Howard of the United States, Figueredo, Kinsel, and Oliver of Jamaica. And this is the second race. There are three semifinal races. The two top qualifiers finishing first and second, plus the two best fastest times. That's Petra Mueller of East Germany in lane three. And she has the fastest time in the world this year.
She's only 22 years old. She's one of those newcomers coming up from East Germany.
In the, by the way, in the first hit, Pina Gina, Julian Richardson, and Lily Leatherwood King, King finishing third, and we will have to wait on her time to see if she will make it through to the final. Here it is, Petra Mueller, lane three, Brisgina in four, and Anine Howard in five. They kind of set the pace for this complete group. They're running 1, 2, 3.
Look at Denine Howard. She looks like she's almost leading right here in all blue. She, at 16 years old, made the Olympic team in 1980. She's going out hard. I like to see that the Americans are getting better, and Denine Howard wants to make that final.
So it is Petra Mueller in lane three, and Brisgina of the Soviet Union in four, pulling away from Denine Howard. Again, the first two are through to the finals, and we'll have to wait on the time of the third. And it is going to be Mueller, Brisgina, and Howard in that order.
We saw Howard run all the way through the finish line hard because she wants to make that final. And of course, it's just the top two, then the next two fastest times.
Now let's go back as they come off of the turn.
We see Mueller, a tall woman with a blue and white shorts on. Look how controlled she is around the turn. She looks like she's running well within herself. Now, Brisgina in second place right here with a red top on. One interesting note is that her husband made it to the finals today in the 100 meters. But Denine Howard in third here, she's really using her arms, trying to make it into that final. But we can see Mueller looks very much under control. Her shoulders are low, and she looks like she's just on cruise control right here.
So it is Petra Mueller of East Germany who takes the second race of the semifinals and sets the scene as the favorite. And we'll have more action for you. But right now, let's go to Dick Enberg. Dick?
All right, Charlie. Petra Mueller, certainly one to watch. The East Germans very strong in that event. We're now going to go to the triple jump qualifying today. You'll recall that in Helsinki 4 years ago, that was one of the most emotional moments when Willie Banks of the U.S. and Hoffman, the pole, Hoffman winning and Banks cheering the crowd, getting them, urging them to jump even better, which Hoffman did. Let's go to Dwight and Larry.
Michael Connolly, considered by many the favorite for the triple jump crown here in Rome, has jumped extremely well the entire year long. World indoor record holder. Yeah. First jump in qualifying looks very good. Right here, there's the automatic qualifier. He is beyond it. 55, 11 and 3 quarters. He can pack up and go home. Here's the defending champion from Helsinki, Zdzislav Hoffman. Very low with his arms. But again, beyond the automatic qualifier, 54, 10 and 3 quarters. All these guys want to do in the morning, just qualify and get back to the hotel.
Here's the world record holder who has not done well in his early couple of attempts, Willie Banks. Out close to the distance from the pitcher's mound to home plate, he's reached almost 60 feet. He's having trouble today, though.
Willie has been very marginal this year. He was good at the TAC meet, but he is really struggling here, and that does not look far enough. 53, 8.5 in his third attempt. He will not qualify for the final on Monday.
This is the American indoor record holder, a man who held the world record there. This is Charlie Simpkins.
Simpkins has also been spotty this year at the National. He was very good. He almost
went
came off the
board.
Runway on
right.
That one. 53, 9 and 3 quarters does also not qualify for the final. Oleg Sakhikin, another one of those Soviet triple jumpers who just seems to come at you every year. A big jump in qualifying. 56, 11 and a quarter. That was the leading qualifier for Monday's final.
And we'll see that tomorrow night on NBC 12:30 Eastern Time. There are the key qualifiers. Mike Conley now, the sole American with the hopes riding now on his shoulders. The Soviets are very strong in this event, figure to come up with a couple of medals. It's good that Hoffman made it. Some were wondering whether he would even arrive here in Rome. Has had a tough year, but he qualifies, however, barely. Those are the qualifiers for the triple jump. And, of course, tomorrow night at 12:30, we will highlight the finals of that most interesting event. We'll return to Rome after this.
Marita Koch holds the world's record in the women's 400 meters. And this is the third semifinal run with Oshifo of Kenya, Chip Curie, Kirsten Immermann of East Germany, Olga Nazarova, Sandy Richards, Diane Dixon of the United States is in sixth, Rita Payne and Uta Tim of West Germany rounding out the lane assignments. Lane six, Diane Dixon. And she has a gold medal from Los Angeles as a member of the 4x400 relay team.
She's only 18 at the time, but she's really coming on this year and last year. She's really improving. She's been in a lot of international competition. She's looking for that sub 50.
First two finishers move forward to the finals, and then the two next best times out of the three heats. And Diane Dixon out at lane six is in a strong contention, as is Kirsten Immermann of East Germany in lane three. So right now it is Immermann and Dixon running 1-2.
Diane's what I would call a feisty competitor, Charlie, because she's going out hard lately. She's not afraid of this field. It used to be that some of the 400-meter women from the United States were afraid of the East Germans. East German is way up here right now, but Diane is going for it. She's got good arm form right here, too.
Immermann, by the way, has run a 50-30 this year, and we did have a scratch. Usifo, a late scratch of Nigeria in lane one, and lane one is open, and here comes Kirsten Immermann, and it is Diane Dixon. Immermann and Dixon. Immermann first, Dixon second. She definitely moves through to the finals. All right.
That's great for Diane, or her nickname's Dee Dee. She really went for that. She was ready here, Tom.
I look at Kirsten Immermann. She could challenge for a medal in the final. Diane Dixon of the United States. And now we'll take them off of the turn.
We see Immelman on the right of the screen. One thing about the East Germans is they have a low arm carriage. Diane, that you see clearly right here in all blue, look at her go to her arms. Right here, your legs feel dead. That's why you've got to go to your arms. You've got to pull those elbows back so that your knees come up. Diane's holding her form well here, and she wants to make that final, and she does.
Immelman and Dixon through to the finals. Women's 400 meters, and now let's join Dick Enberg.
All right, Charlie Jones, and tomorrow we'll have the finals of the women's 400 and two Americans in the running, although they would have to be considered somewhat a long shot for a medal. Leatherwood King and Diane Dixon, because the three Soviets are very tough, and Mueller and Immelman are getting a lot of regard here, and many feel that Mueller is the woman to beat. Richardson of Canada also a long shot. We look ahead to today's final matchup between the two fastest men in the world, Ben Johnson, number one and has been for the last couple of years, and so fast they say that old cool Papa Bell line that turns off the lights and he's in bed before the lights go out. We'll return to Rome after this Olympic moment. it's always fun to watch the walkers. Sometimes it appears as if someone shot a gun and a bunch of ducks go off on a strong walk, but it's a very serious and a very difficult event, 20 kilometers today, and it's especially interesting because the Italians have been waiting for this Sunday of the World Championships because Maurizio Damilano, his twin brother, also a walker, is his coach. He is considered to be the favorite in this event. And they're ready with their flags, and they're ready for their voices, and they'll be following the action on the television screens in the stadium as the walkers leave, and they'll be ready to cheer should their countrymen come in first hour or so from now. Now let's go to Charlie Jones.
Maurizio Damilano is on everybody's lips in the stadium, Dick, just as you pointed out, from Italy. And is the favorite, and they're just waiting to cheer throughout this whole race.
I think his main competition will probably come from Ernesto Canto from Mexico. The Mexicans have a very strong walking tradition, as do the Italians. The Italians have always done very well.
Canto, of course, the 1984 Olympic champion, and he is the world record holder.
And Damilano is the 1980 Olympic champion. So you have the 80 Olympic champion and the 84 Olympic champion. 6:93 on the inside is Ernesto Canto taking the early lead, and Carlos Mercenario, his teammate, on his right.
And he is number 6:99. A very technical, but yet a very subjective event in the world of track and field.
I'm not sure which takes precedence here, the technique or the judging. I sometimes think the judging is the harder part of the event because the athletes are supposed to have one foot on the ground at all time, and the rear leg, as it comes back, has to straighten out. It is very, very difficult to judge, and it's very subjective.
And as we swing back behind the co-leaders, Mostikov of the Soviet Union, Kostadinova of the Soviet Union is there. Fesler is one of them. Blazik of Czechoslovakia is a Marin of Spain. We expect to see him up near the front. He's back closer to the middle of the pack right now.
And in sixth place, the man in the all-white is Maurizio Damilano from Italy, so he's well-placed right up in the front. The two Mexican walkers in front, Canto and Mercenario, they would train together. The whole Mexican team tends to live together for extended periods of time around Mexico City. They train at altitude. They have a whole really stable of very good walkers.
Can you relate this event to the distance running of the marathon, of setting the early pace of where you want to be, of your strategy? Is it the same kind of a mind game?
I think it is, but this 20-kilometer walk is more of a sprint for these athletes. The 50-kilometer walk is really the endurance event. Believe it or not, they will be out there for about an hour and 20 minutes approximately, and for them, this is really their sprint event. So doling out your energy is very important, but you really have to go pretty much all out for the whole distance in this event. Just a little bit about the judging. The judges, there are three judges who can disqualify an athlete. You can get a warning from any one judge. They hold up a white card and it says you have a warning. Then if three judges decide together that you are indeed off the ground, then they can disqualify you. They go to the head judge takes you off. But in order to try to make it a little more fair, you have to have a judge from a different country. Three different judges from three different countries have to decide an athlete's out because it is very subjective. It's very difficult to judge.
When they go outside of the stadium, it's a different kind of a course that they run than the marathoners.
They will go outside the stadium and then run six laps around a 2,500-meter course, come back.
Well, Damilano, and it must be difficult for those judges, he won the gold in Moscow in 80 in this event when the two men in front of him were disqualified. So that could be part of the story. We're going to switch now to East Germany, that 100 meters for women, the finals coming up. One of the up-and-coming sprinters in East Germany, Silke Gladisch, she's 23. The East German sprinters went to Mexico City to train at high altitude, all but Gladisch. She stayed and beat them all in the national championships in East Germany, and Dwight Stones was there.
East Germany has a tradition of great sprinters. Marita Koch is now retired. Marlies Göhr is nearing the twilight of her career. And now it seems the tradition has passed to Silke Gladisch.
And In Rome, I'll be running against the excellent athletes from the United States and Jamaica. I really don't consider myself the favorite because of the many rounds I'm going to have to run. With a little bit of luck, I think anyone can win 100 meters here.
She's known for a start so fast and for running so far ahead of the pack that if she's ahead in the first 30 meters, she can't be caught.
Das ist immer so eine Sache, wenn man vorne läuft, wenn man vorne
when
ist,
you're
dann läuft man immer locker, aber wenn man merkt, dass sich noch einer ist, ganz klar, dann wird man automatisch immer
That's why I really admire Ben Johnson. He's always relaxed. He takes the lead and never looks back.
Ist ja die ersten Meter vorne und dann hält den Vorsprung. Das ist immer ganz fantastisch, ihm zuzusehen.
She is guardedly optimistic about the world record relay team's chances in Rome.
Hat bei uns in letzter Zeit nicht ganz so geklappt. Die Zeiten waren natürlich nicht so entsprechend, wie man sich das erhofft hatte. Aber wenn der Wechsel klappt, so
If the passes are good, we'll be fine. They worked out in Canberra, but we can set a world record here too if we pass correct.
So Gladisch also looking ahead to the sprint relay and a factor in the 100 meter finals coming up shortly. Now, we've seen the semifinals. Drechsler wins her semi and Gladisch hers. Gladisch with an explosive start. Drechsler coming from way behind with those long legs. Now, as teammates, Evelyn Ashford, well, there's 2 hours between the semis and the finals. Will they go back? Will they be associated all with each other? Will they try to ignore each other? Are they forced together? What happens now?
Usually you go back and you get with your personal coach. And you talk about what you did wrong and what needs to be done. Usually might get a light rub or something and just lay down and relax and just hope to God you're the first one at the finish line.
Did you talk to your U.S. teammates when you went into a final, a key final, a big championship?
Oh, my goodness. This is wartime. And you don't really talk to anybody except your coach who's close to you and needs to point out things you might need to do. And you're just trying to relax and forget the pressure because you know this is it. This is it.
In a way, it's while you're on a team, that when it comes down to this moment, it's strictly an individual sport.
At this moment, it really is.
I'm going to put you on the spot now. You've got Ottey in the field, a fine Jamaican runner. You've got the two East Germans, an American. Whom do you like and why?
I like Gladisch because she looks much sharper today than she did yesterday. Her start is explosive, and she gets out, and she just keeps going. The other runners aren't doing that. Drexler's having trouble with her start, I think mostly because she's new to sprinting and racing. You can run fast, but you have to know how to race, and Drexler is new to racing. I think Ottey is a third-place finisher no matter who's in the race. That's just been her... Her pattern.
So you like the two East Germans. Needless to say, we've been talking about the men's 100 meters and a possible world record. They're going after yours as well. We'll see that 100 meter finals. Right now, these words from your local station.
The World Championships of Track and Field from Rome are being brought to you.
Award-winning Bud Greenspan joins us again today in our Rome studios. Bud with us throughout these championships with his own unique look at the human side of the track and field star. And unique certainly does apply to that leggy, beautiful Wilma Rudolph in 1960 here in Rome.
Dick, if it wasn't true, they'd throw us out if we try to do a film on Wilma as a piece of fiction, because everything that could possibly happen in the bad Hollywood movies of the 1930s happened to Wilma. One of 26 children, unable to walk without braces till she's 20, till she's 11 years old. And here we see her in the Rome Olympic Stadium after all this was over and standing atop the victory platform, the winner of the gold medal in 100 meters.
To overcome all of that, still be a gold medalist, and yet she won injured.
Here's the funny part of it. As we found out when we saw her in the preliminaries of the 100 meters that she had a tape on her leg, and we asked her what happened. And she said the day before the preliminaries took place, she twisted her ankle on a water sprinkler on the practice field just 200 meters from where we're sitting here now. But she came back 4 days later here in the 100 meters, Wilma Rudolph winning the 100 at the time and equaling the world records of 1960.
You can see on her left leg, the heavy bandage, it didn't seem to hamper her performance. That was the first of her three gold medals.
Well, Wilma was something very special because even though Fanny Blancas Kuhn, you know, had two children when she won the four gold medals in 1948, Wilma, very few people know, was the mother of a small child, a year old, just born the year before the Olympic Games of 1960. But she came on to become the champion that she is. She is such a series of contradictions, because everything that is supposed to happen with athletes and didn't happen to Wilma. Here she is now in the 200 meters. Wilma will be on the inside lane, closest to the infield. And an interesting, dramatic thing took place for me in this particular one. Because here's Wilma, one of 24 children, a poor Tennessee family. And the young lady she beats out is Jutta Heine of West Germany, who's the daughter of a millionaire in West Germany. So it's just a funny situation of first and second place here, this poor girl defeating this multimillionaire.
The one I remember, though, is, although those were two great performances, was the fact that she had to come from behind anchoring the 4x100 relay to give the U.S. team the gold.
You know, Dick, she said that was her finest victory, her greatest victory, her most satisfying victory, because she was with her three teammates from Tennessee State. As you know, Coach Ed Temple was named the coach of the women's team. And here's Wilma crossing the finish line. And when she crossed the finish line with such exuberance and exultation, she said she was inspired by the fact that Ed Temple was her coach at Tennessee State. But even more so, she wanted her three teammates that went to school with her at Tennessee State to share that greatness with her. So you can see the happiness in her face on the left of your screen with her three teammates, because she was with them for 2 years. Now this camaraderie that took place in Rome was continued. And she said when she stood on the victory platform, they were sort of almost singing the Tiger Bell song that they sang as they used to practice and run and jump on the playing field of Tennessee State.
Thank you, Bud. It's great to relive the moments of Wilma Rudolph in the Rome Olympics of 1960, a woman who inspired so many others to run. And as Muhammad Ali said in his book, I fell in love with Wilma Rudolph in Rome in 60. He wasn't alone. The Eternal City, the host of these second World Championships of track and field along the Tiber River here in the great city of Rome, and we've been treated on this Sunday to a world record. A 22-year-old Bulgarian, Stefka Kostadinova, has leaped 6'10 and a quarter, bettering her own world mark. Already these World Championships special. And here again is Kostadinova springing over the bar and, after missing on her first try, kicking with her heels, able to clear for the record to the delight of this crowd of well over 50,000 at Olympic Stadium in Rome. It's interesting that of the four gold medals earned in the championship so far, they've been won by Kenya, Switzerland, Portugal, and now Bulgaria, the superpowers yet to win a gold. The United States, the Soviets, and the East Germans still looking for that first trip to the top pedestal here at Olympic Stadium. The 800 meters coming up now in Olympic Stadium, and the American record holder is in this round, Johnny Gray in the fifth lane. Let's go to Charlie Jones.
Johnny Gray of the United States is in lane five. This is the fourth heat of the men's 800 meters. Suonen, Morel, Barbosa, Niang, Johnny Gray, Bernard, Inholm, and Braun are all in this heat. The three top finishers plus the four next best times will be coming through.
And Johnny Gray and Jose Luis Barbosa. Barbosa's in the yellow. Gray behind him, just pushing the athlete in front of him. Really, this could be a replay of the final. Out of those two will probably be medalists in the final. They're jogging now. They're settling in, and they're just going to let somebody lead through the first lap.
Suonen of Finland inside, in reality, has the early lead, but everybody seems to be just looking around, checking where everybody is.
And if Johnny Gray has a fault, it's that he tends to run wide. Look at him. He's on the left-hand side. Barbosa making a move, not getting boxed, in second place.
And Martin Inholm of Sweden now takes the lead on the bell lap.
And Barbosa ran a very smart race. He's in second place, well positioned. Johnny Gray is really in trouble here.
He is way back, running next to last. Now he starts to make a move down the back straight.
I hope he's running easily. He seems to be gaining on them now, but someone's making a break.
And that is Niang of Senegal.
And he is no slouch. He's a good runner. Barbosa's going after him, and Johnny Gray is getting left. Johnny Gray, something is wrong with him. He may not qualify unless he really starts to move here.
Barbakar Niang of Senegal moving out in front as he leads coming down the final straight.
And this is a big upset. Johnny Gray will not qualify. This is one of the upsets of the games. He's starting to jog. Niang will win. Barboza's second, and Johnny Gray just jogging through right out of the gate and out of this competition.
He jogs across the line, turns right, and heads for home.
A big disappointment for Johnny Gray. He looked okay with one lap to go, and he's saying to himself, I don't know what's wrong. Some days you just don't have it, but usually not by that much. Johnny Gray in the back. We thought it was strategy for a while, but look at him. He's just not driving. His arms are not moving, and this is where everyone accelerates going into the last turn. Barboza in second, going after Niang, and you can see Johnny Gray running on the outside. He's saying, okay, now I'll punch it. I'll put the pedal to the floor and see what happens. He puts it down and shifts into reverse. Niang in front, running very well, and Barboza running smoothly, jogging through. Very soon will be Johnny Gray.
A disappointment in the World Championships, Johnny Gray of the United States.
Now, that's part of the reality of these great championships as well. David Mack then is the only American to move through these qualifying rounds as Stanley Redwine, also the U.S., did not make it. There is the field, Morocco's lobby. Barboza, a definite threat for a big medal. From Brazil, two Kenyans, Ostrowski the Pole, Elliott from Great Britain, and Fall of Senegal completing the field. Meanwhile, Maurizio Damilano, the 20-kilometer walk. The Italians are looking for their hero. Let's go to the Olympic Stadium.
Lights, Maurizio Damilano.
Damilano has been out in the front. You can't really see from here, but they're early on in the walk. Damilano has been in the front, but really pushing the pace so far has been Viktor Mustovic from the Soviet Union. Again, a very good walker. At this stage in the competition, it's sometimes difficult to tell because in the walk, since they're going relatively slower, the packs tend to stay together for longer. But they go along at 620, 630, 640 per mile pace, which means they're really moving along much faster than you get in perspective from this long lens. And here they come around the corner. Those are the two Mexicans still leading with Damilano in third place. Canto and Mercenario first and second with Damilano right behind.
This type of a format, the way that the course is laid out, an advantage or a disadvantage from the walker standpoint, going out and back and constantly seeing the other runners, the other walkers? Excuse me for letting that slip, because some of them do run, and if they're caught, they're disqualified.
I think it's an advantage, and it's just tradition. That's what they do. They go out and they walk loops, probably because they don't really want hills. Traditionally, the walks have always been very flat races, and so they'll find a flat section near the stadium and go on it.
Advantage for the Mexicans to continue to lead.
It's an advantage because they can pull each other along. Now, they're walking very well. They're fairly well along in the competition here now. I think they've been out. They're about two-thirds of the way through. Damilano, you can see him cutting the tangent, really walking a little smarter than the Mexicans. It's Canto in front pushing the pace, and he is the better of the two.
And there's a lot of teamwork in this event from all countries.
There is, in pulling each other along, and I think with the rhythm, because again, you're trying not to lift off the ground, and I think in the walk, if you can fall into a teammate's rhythm, you're more likely to be able to keep one foot on the ground at all times. And they're pressing, they're trying to break away.
Now, in a marathon, within the pack, there's conversation going on, particularly during the first...
They just pulled Canto out of the competition, which means three judges from three different countries have decided he's been off the ground. They've gone to the head judge. He's already had a warning, probably, that we didn't see, and they just pulled him off, and he's saying, why here? This doesn't happen at home.
And one of the controversy involving the walking event is the disqualifications, and it always seems as if it's one of the leaders that's disqualified.
And here we have two people from Mexico giving an Italian a hard time, the Mexican disqualified.
Now let's go to Dwight and Larry.
As we stated earlier, we'll be covering the men's javelin throw competition today, and Larry, that competition's wide open.
Well, it is, Dwight. 100 feet has been added to the javelin distance since 1932. The end result is now, under the old javelin up until a year ago, you could stand in the end zone of a football field, fire at the length of the football field, and the world record would go out the other end, out past the end zone. 343 feet. And the officials were worried that at some track meet, that spear might stick actually in the third lane of the track, killing someone. So what they did was they flattened out the javelin's tail a bit, adding some drag. They also moved the center of gravity forward just a bit. The end result is we have basically a new event, don't we?
And not only that, most stadiums are built for a headwind, which was what was conducive to the old javelin.
Right.
Now, you need a tailwind for the new javelin, and all the stadiums are not really conducive for good flights of that implement.
It's true. Many of the javelin throwers, when you talk to them, would talk about it being a brute strength event right now. Yet I think the surprise is some of the people who are not as big as East Germany's giant Uwe Hahn, who had the world record, are smaller men still throwing the implement pretty well.
And I think also it takes a little bit more finesse than it used to.
I will. I'm looking forward to what will happen here today. Two Americans are in the final. Duncan Atwood, Tom Petronoff. Let's see what they can do. They certainly are close to the world record distance for the new javelin.
Well, anybody can win this one, and we'll be back with that competition right after this. Jan Zulesny of Czechoslovakia, the current world record holder with the new javelin at 287.7, up for his second throw here in the World Championships.
Dwight, this is the first change in this implement since the Trojan War.
The flight is completely different. It starts to flatten out right at the top of the flight of the throw, whereas in the old days, the nose would stay up and it would carry further. But this is a good throw for him, 269 feet, 8 inches, to take the lead.
This is American Tom Petronoff. He has the American record at just over 280 feet with the new spear.
Tom was the silver medalist 4 years ago in Helsinki, and he was very upset about the change in the implement.
But really, he's done very well with it.
He's made the transition very well, and it's because he is strong and he also knows how to manipulate the instrument. 264 feet, that puts him in third place currently. This is Lev Shatilo of the Soviet Union. A number of new throwers have come up because the instrument has been better suited for their style of throwing.
Watch the left leg act as a brake here and the rest of the body whip forward. It dives like a bomber.
And he takes third and pushes Petronoff into fourth with 265.10. Up to the booth and Charlie Jones.
This is the first semifinal heat, women's 800 meters. Diane Edwards is in lane one. Jarmila Kraktobilova, Czechoslovakia, is in lane two. Anna Kirot is in three. Essie Warsh, United States, in four. Brzmitsky is in five. Bodars, Garina, and Chilovic rounding out the field. And this is a good field in the semifinals. Jarmila Kraktobilova, the world record holder, 153.28. She set that in 1983. And she is in lane two. Now, she's not running the way that she was in Helsinki 4 years ago. You will recall the impossible double, winning the 400 and the 800.
You know, people were so impressed with her there. She is power personified. But here, Charlie, it seems like the muscles are almost getting in the way. She's been running tight all year. She was off 18 months with injury, now trying to make a comeback, was going to retire. She's now at the age of 36, I believe, but she is making a comeback, but not too sharp.
One of the favorites in lane three is Anna Kirot of Cuba.
She's one of my picks, Charlie. She won the Pan American Games in the 400 meter and the 800 meters. And I think it's interesting because we all remember in the 1976 games when Alberto Wantorino did the double, and he's also was from Cuba, but she looked sharp yesterday.
And outside in lane eight from Yugoslavia, Cholovic is also one of the favorites. This is the first of two semifinal heats, women's 800 meters. There's Cholovic of Yugoslavia, outside in lane eight. Slobodanka Cholovic. In lane two, Jarmila Kraktobilova, and of course you remember her from Helsinki with that impossible double in the 400 and 800, now 36 years old. But it's good to see her in the semifinals.
She's one of the best women runners in the world, middle distance-wise, and some people laugh. She's so muscular, she looks like the Arnold Schwarzenegger of women's running.
Anna Kirot of Cuba, one of the favorites. And she goes right out along with Essie Washington of the United States.
Kirot wanted to do the double here. She's in all red. She's now boxed in behind there, but she couldn't do it at this meet.
Cholovic of Yugoslavia takes the lead. No,
here's
that's Essie.
Washington.
That's Essie with the lead.
That's
Essie with the lead. Cholovic is in second.
Americans need to go out and run towards the front. The Americans like Essie. Essie doesn't have, she can't get her legs turning over quick at the end, so she needs to force the pace early.
And meanwhile, Kraktuk Bilova is just sitting along the rail, and she's running third or fourth.
No, that's not her style at all. But Wooters, in the blue top and the white short, is moving up.
And Wooters is in third place. She's from East Germany. And now Essie's beginning to struggle just a bit as Cholovich takes the lead.
That was a fast 400 meters, 57.08. So it's a good pace.
Tiro of Cuba, and moving up on her right shoulder from East Germany is Wooters.
She was second in the East German Championships just a week ago. She looks, you know, she looks so easy there. And here is the third 200 of the race where a lot of people want to slow down and take it easy, but she looks like she's going to take the lead.
And it is Zegra Wooters of East Germany with the lead. And now Cholovich of Yugoslavia, it moves up to third.
Hero still looks good. She's in fourth now, and she looks like she's just getting ready to make her move.
And Garina of the Soviet Union is second, and coming up on the outside is the challenger, Anna Kirot of Cuba. And again, three will move through. Top three finishers will move through. And here comes Kraktuk Bilova inside, struggling for fourth.
Could
but
make
the top
it.
Three finishers are definitely through to the next round, to the final.
Anna Kirot had her best time a couple weeks ago in Berlin, 156, and she's just really coming into her own this year, Charlie.
Let's go back and take a look at the final straight.
Wooters in the lead right here. She looks very controlled, though. Notice that her shoulders are down. She's keeping her form, and this is where you really get tight this last straight, and all of a sudden here comes Kirot on the outside in the red. She's keeping her arm drive good. Knees are still coming up, even though she's tired, and that's the key. You've got to keep your form all the way through.
Kiro, Wooters, Cholovich, the top three.
Back to the men's javelin. Seppo Ratti of Finland up for his third round throw. But back in the first round, talk about not feeling very confident. You come out for your first round of the World Championships. He slips, sticks the javelin in the runway short of fouling. Gets to go back. He has a minute left for his concentration, and he completed the throw. He's up for his third round throw now. Let's see what he can do.
Dwight, that was a brilliant move.
This is the national sport practically in Finland.
And he gets it out there a good distance, 270 feet. And that takes the lead. So in a little less than 20 minutes, he went from despair to being the leader. Tom Petronoff, America's hope for a medal in this particular event, is currently third. ...266 feet, 8 inches. And that keeps him right where he is. He's into fourth.
Watch Petronoff now. The leg should be planted before the arm begins its forward motion. The spear should be up behind the right ear in this case, the elbow above the shoulder when the release occurs. Everything is done to create a whip-like motion.
The idea is to try to throw the entire javelin through the point, the tip of the javelin, which is very difficult to do. That's where the finesse of the event comes in. Petronoff, however, is struggling. Let's go back to Dick in the studio.
Despite that disastrous first attempt by Ratti, the Finn, he, with a strong throw, perhaps be one of the surprises in these championships. He was not highly regarded coming in. Of course, that was the only gold medal for the host Finns in Helsinki when Tiina Lilak won the gold for the women in the javelin. Let's summarize quickly the women's discus event, perhaps one of the weakest for the United States women and certainly one of the strongest for the East Germans, and it would not be a surprise if this was an event that the East Germans swept. Their top throw today by an 18-year-old, Ilka Viluda. She is a schoolgirl, was the 86th World Junior Champion, and this is the top qualifying throw, 224 feet, 5 inches by Viluda from Leipzig. Just 18 and already a strong event, and apparently the East Germans even stronger. And you just look for GDR, the East Germans, and they're the ones to beat right there in the middle in this event. And it might well be a gold, silver, and a bronze. And the two Americans, Price and Katie, did not make it through. Well, coming up, a very serious piece here on our coverage from Rome. Ecclesia, LA Youth and Sports, Athletic Association, or cult. Stay with us. Dixon, Connie Price from Sioux City, Iowa, does advance, qualifying in the women's discus. World championships to a worldly problem. The children of our world, how to love them, educate them, motivate them, inspire them in athletics. In the inner city of Los Angeles, there's a program, Ecclesia, unique, controversial, provocative. This is a serious piece. We hope you'll listen carefully. What do you think? Greg Lewis reports.
Youth athletic camps, training grounds for America's sports heroes of tomorrow. In good tennis, girl. Nick Boltieri's Florida Academy nurtures the dream of victories on Wimbledon's center court.
One.
Little League Baseball. It's the first stop en route to Yankee Stadium, if you hustle. For aspiring Mary Lou's, the place to be is Houston, under the watchful eye of Bella Caroli. And in Southern California, the Ecclesia Athletic Association says it will produce runners who can climb the steps to Olympic glory. Head coach and founder of Ecclesia is Eldridge Broussard, a former basketball star at Oregon Pacific University, a Portland Trailblazer tryout, and an ordained minister in the Church of God in Christ. His headquarters, a converted bakery in the Los Angeles neighborhood of his youth, Watts. It's the cradle of his dream.
The bulk of our athletes here we expect to see in 96 and 2000 in particular. We have at least 20 to 25 athletes that we feel by the year 2000, they will be the best in the world. But what we had hoped is that by 1988, we would have at least one, probably two or three athletes who would be Olympic caliber, who would be gold medal caliber, who would be able to say, we got this training in the Ecclesia program.
And what is the Ecclesia program?
We are more than just that. We have a purpose that is deeper than sweat. We are athletes, but our game is strong. We can hang, we can run all day long. The game we play is a survival game. Getting prepared so we won't be ashamed.
The specific purpose that we have chosen to use the word Ecclesia for is instead of being trapped in a mindset that has been formulated by normal ghetto, drug culture, gang culture, phenomena, come out and grab whatever has been put at your disposal to improve yourself, improve the community, improve the people around you. We would like to say it's not too late to shoot for greatness, and we would like to be allowed to dare to believe.
Sharing Broussard's vision, Carolyn Van Brunt, fired from her position as community officer for the Los Angeles Olympic Organizing Committee as a result of her increasing involvement with Ecclesia, now serves as the group's public relations director.
We're going to keep on working, keep our bodies in shape, keep learning, and keep striving for higher things. Although people think we're, you know, grandiose and megalomaniacs and whatever all they may think, we dream high and we go for it, we shoot for it.
Man, when you're from Watts and you're on the bottom of the rung anyway, you better shoot high. You might as well shoot high. It might take that kind of high shooting just to get to the next level. Life is a gamble. And with all of the particular obstacles in front of us, what do we have to lose?
What Broussard has to lose is the dream itself. A recent effort to establish a training center for Ecclesia's 100 members, 45 children and 55 adults in rural Sandy, Oregon, southeast of Portland, provoked community alarm and unfavorable national press. The June 29 issue of Newsweek characterized Eldridge Broussard as a shadowy guru.
They had no right to call me a shadowy guru. I mean, why would they do that? I have been a coach from Jump Street as it relates to Ecclesia Athletic Association.
Some Oregonians, Newsweek reported, feared Ecclesia's training camp would overrun their community, just as the followers of the Bhagwan Sri Rajneesh swarmed over Antelope, Oregon, only 95 miles away and far closer in memory.
They represented me wrong, and they have made it extremely difficult to get my program off the ground. They're going to regret that.
You've been slandered?
Yes.
You've been libeled?
Yes.
And you want retribution?
Yes. I mean, that's the Constitution grants me. I can collect damages.
But if Broussard wants constitutional redress, he'll have to open his doors and abandon his style of secrecy.
What we tried to do was keep a very qualitative mystery around this. We wanted to train in secrecy. It becomes marketable when it is not common. Is there mystery around Michael Jackson? I mean, isn't it a big deal when you see him?
The secret techniques are not for us to see.
Oh, no, not now. I mean, you know, your viewers are so used to getting everything for free. Now, I'll tell you what, if you can go get one of your corporate sponsors to say, these people say they have some techniques. Now, if you give them a grant, they may let us come in and film some of these techniques. You do that, I'll show up some of our techniques.
The Ecclesia Athletic Association. One moment, its founder, Eldridge Broussard, says you can't see its secret training techniques. The next, he says,
I challenge you to take the time to scrutinize every aspect of my program and see if after you have put it into context, whether or not this is a guru or an innovator.
If roller skating produces track stars, Broussard is an innovator. But is he forthcoming?
No hurdles, no track, no starting guns, no stopwatches. Or is this somewhere that nobody has seen it?
Oh, we have stopwatches. We had a little girl break a leg over a hurdle one time. We have the starting, I mean, we have all the things that people have conventionally. Make sure that that camera you brought tunes in across the street and see there's a track right across the street. And there are bleachers that we run every day.
Well, the Ecclesia Athletic Association has been in our community for the 3.5 years that I've been assigned as principal of Fremont High School. And they use our track occasionally in a recreational manner. I have not seen formal training in terms of starter pistols, hurdles, and starting blocks.
But if Ecclesia's dream was to establish its Olympic camp on this farm in Sandy, Oregon, maybe the serious, more traditional training was taking place here. Neighbors like Jack Strand were excited to have potential Olympians moving in down the road at first.
The notion that they were an athletic organization didn't make any sense to us when we saw what they were doing.
Explain that.
Well, we'd see 50 to 60 children standing at attention for up to an hour at a time. Or we'd see mass calisthenics, but we saw no attempt at real athletic training.
Before we even get into the 100 meters, before we ever get into the 220, before we ever get into basketball, we give them the ability to endure.
Ecclesia's purported world-class runners could have proved their endurance in Oregon's 15K Cascade Runoff. Nike executive and race director Chuck Gulford.
We did receive 85 or 86 entries from Ecclesia. Our entry blanks require people to fill in their estimated finish time. All the finish times on the Ecclesia entry blanks were identical, which were approximately 1 hour slower than the winning time would be.
Ecclesia's athletes withdrew from the Cascade Runoff when officials refused to waive their entry fee. Money, like training techniques, is another Ecclesia mystery.
Currently, we have five people. We had seven. And now, as a matter of fact, we had seven, we have six. They fund this whole, and I talk about who they are, because they could be super rich or they could be somebody struggling. And I want to keep that mystery around them for a moment because that's part of our marketability. But we take no offerings.
But Ecclesia has in the past. A large sports equipment manufacturer, New Balance, donated shoes and clothing to Ecclesia 4 years ago. Though Ecclesians still wear New Balance equipment, New Balance is no longer involved.
Receive tax-deductible donations.
I've researched our records here, and we find no record of the Ecclesia being an exempt organization for federal tax purposes.
And the day before we spoke to Eldridge Broussard, the state of California suspended Ecclesia's nonprofit status. But there are more troubling allegations involving the welfare of Ecclesia children.
Tell me about the children. How are they educated?
Watts Christian Center, which is the school that the kids are a part of, long time ago adopted a posture that we wanted our kids to learn how to be perceptive and be able to glean in whatever environment they were in. Watts Christian School and the people who are a part of Watts Christian Center School and training program provide a total programming and socialization package for our kids that allows them to read and write and arithmetic and learn through things that we think will be meaningful for them throughout the whole of their existence.
A preliminary check by our staff indicates that the Watts Christian Center
is not registered as a private school with the Los Angeles County Office of Education or the Los Angeles Unified School District.
Relatives of Ecclesia members are also concerned about education and more. Mary Stanton's daughter and two grandchildren are Ecclesians.
There is resentment there because it's like he has taken something away from me insofar and my family insofar as the maybe not companionship, but the opportunity to see my grandchildren at different stages of their growth, the opportunity to be able to talk to my daughter as mother and daughter.
Their people having problems with their relatives, man. They didn't have to go join Ecclesia to do it.
I see those young children growing up and even into young adulthood and being unable to get out of there because, number one, they will not be free mentally to get out of there. They will not have an education. They will not be able to go to school. They will not be able to do anything. And if they do come out and they become a failure, then they'll have to run right back in.
I am not asking anybody to come follow me to anywhere. I am asking people to come follow my example.
In my research, relating to groups, whether it is Ecclesia or another group, are number one, alienation from family, friends, and the larger society are to be suspect.
We're committed to this thing. We believe it's worth giving our life to. We're going to see to it that we finish this project to the end and then let our inner faith and conviction sustain us until we reach our goal.
I just want to be the best in the world.
In sports or in life?
We hone that athletic opportunity into a platform to educate, and by the time the year 2000 runs around, there are supreme athletes that have been well-rounded in an international education, and we believe that we have been given an opportunity to give that to the kids that are here.
Don't try to make everybody super men and super women. It will not happen. If there's any way to destroy an individual, it is to try to make them supermen and superwomen.
Ask Eldridge Broussard what he's about, and he's likely to tell you to read the biblical book of Romans. But that's a clue that really only increases the mystery. Romans 11:33 says, "How unsearchable are his judgments, and how inscrutable his ways."
There are 45 adults and 55 children in the Ecclesia Athletic Association. It's thought-provoking indeed, giving kids hope, dreams, secretly, or is Ecclesia no formal education, undue pressure? Back after these words. In history, Edwin Moses will be 32 tomorrow, and then the satellite didn't cooperate. We didn't see visually his race. So we're going to go back to Moses in action today.
This is round one of the men's 400-meter hurdles, heat number one. We will have the top two finishers moving through to the finals with the four best other times. It'll be a total of six heats. Lane one is open. Edwin Moses is in two. Gillingham is in three. Zimmerman is in four. Umiki is in five. Kimolari is in six. Kitor is in seven. And Yoshida is in eight. And, of course, all eyes will be on lane two. Edwin Moses, the world record holder with a 47.02, August the 31st. 1983, defending champion and two-time Olympic champion. He's in lane two. Again, lane one is open.
Edwin should have no trouble in this heat, but he's still fun to watch because he's the best hurdler in history. He just goes over the barrier so well.
And already he begins to close the stagger on Martin Gillingham of Great Britain, who is in lane three just to his right.
Charlie, unlike some of the flat races where in the early rounds athletes back off, you can't really do that so much in the hurdles because if you do, it throws your steps off. So you have to run fairly hard every race. So he'll win this by a whole bunch, not because he's hot-dogging, but because he has to. He doesn't want to throw himself off.
And again, the top two finishers will move through to the finals. Out in lane five from Nigeria is Henry Amike. And he is now drifting back to second place. And Edwin Moses will coast in, moving to the next round.
Edwin ran a low 48 race there. That's pretty fast for the early rounds. That would be the fourth or fifth best time in the world this year. But again, he has to run pretty fast because it's such a technical event.
And as you say, he is just, he's such a great athlete. It's fun to watch him in any race.
Watch his head as he goes over the hurdles. It probably will not go up very much. He chopped a little bit on his steps, but he's a fine hurdler. He just has such control over his body, right back into the same rhythm. You could play one piece of film on top of another, it wouldn't change. You can see he draws in a little bit, pulls up his lead leg, and just runs right over the hurdle. And that's what's so unique about Edwin. His legs are just about as long on the inseam as the hurdles are high, so he can literally step right over them. And he's got his timing down so much, he's got so much experience that this kind of trial really is easy for him. The only threat to him is if he hits a hurdle and falls down. Edwin coming down the home stretch. He's relaxed. He runs the same number of steps between each hurdle. They're all meted out. He runs the exact same distance on each stride. He's just fun to watch because technically he's the best person that's ever been in this event.
An unofficial 49.03 for Edwin Moses.
In this city, like a moving Michelangelo sculpture, Edwin Moses. Looking for another gold. Let's go back to the 800 meters in this qualifying heat. Delisa Walton Floyd of the United States trying to make a comeback from maternity leave.
Second semifinal heat, women's 800 meters. The world record held by Yarmila Kroktovileva, 153.28. Here are the lane assignments. Akraka of Sweden, Maria Akraka, is in lane one. Christina Wachtel is in lane two of East Germany. She would be the favorite. Sedlakova is in lane three. Oli Zarenko is in four. Joetta Clark of the United States in five. Zhengyi Atu of Romania is in six. Tuma of France is in seven. And Lisa Walton Floyd of the United States is outside in lane eight. And there is Christiana Wachtel.
She's a very explosive runner in the 800 meters. She has a short stride, but she goes after it. And she just ran 155 last week, which is the fastest time in the world this year. So she's running well.
And in lane four from the Soviet Union, Oli Zarenko is the former world record holder and the 1980 Olympic champion.
At top 35 three, years old now.
Yes. At top three finishers moving through to the finals, plus the two fastest times, two fastest other times in the two semifinal heats.
Joetta Clark, you can barely see her. They're in all blue. She's going to have to go out. And also, we have Delisa Walton Floyd in this in the very outside lane, lane eight, Delisa Walton Floyd from the United States.
Did Joetta Clark or Delisa Walton Floyd have a chance here to make it through to the finals?
Delisa looked better yesterday, Charlie, but Delisa's going to have to go out in the front because one problem the Americans have is they don't have the quick turnover the last 100 meters.
And going out in front is Christina Wachtel of East Germany.
She's such a star in this field that she knows that she can control this race, and she's out of trouble as far as getting tripped, and she's just very, she's running very easily right here, you can tell.
And the Romanian is running in third, and that's Zhengyi Atu of Romania. Lisa Walton Floyd is running very comfortably in second, right off of the shoulder, Christina Wachtel.
Delisa's having her best season ever. She's got a three-year-old child, and her and Joetta both were at the University of Tennessee, I might say, and Delisa ran her PR last week.
Number 512, Maria Akraka of Sweden, moving into third now and is swinging outside, but cannot challenge the top two runners.
Very tactical, Charlie. 61 seconds for the first 400 meter. That is a walking pace for these women. And Delisa is going to have to start pushing it on the backstretch if she does want to qualify.
And Christina Wachtel of East Germany continues to lead, and Delisa Walton Floyd stays right with her. Now the challenge will come from the outside.
Christine Wachtel on the inside. She's controlling this race from the gun. She's very compact, and she's got very quick turnover.
Sedlakova of Czechoslovakia challenged, and then Wachtel takes it out, and that's Wachtel and Sedlakova. And now from the Soviet Union, Oli Zarenko. But right now, from Czechoslovakia, Sedlakova inside from East Germany, it is Wachtel.
Let's watch it change right here. All of a sudden, the arms are going to start pumping. Everything is going to be a complete sprint right here. And see, that's what happens to the Americans. They can't sprint with the Europeans.
And it is Vakto with the Romanian challenging for second. And it is Vakto, Jungiatu finishing second, and Ole Zarenko of the Soviet Union coming in third. Let's go back to the stretch run.
Vakto on the inside. She doesn't have the most smoothest form with her arms. They're kind of out wide, but she's so powerful and she can get those feet going so quick. Good knee lift there. And they are so much quicker. They have the quick turnover. They practice this. They can change gears, and that's what you have to do in 800 meters, change gears. Lizarenko on the outside at 35 years old. She still looks strong there. I think we could see more of her. She kept her arm drive low all the way through. She looked relaxed.
So Vakto of East Germany, one of the eight finalists in the women's 800-meter run. Her teammate Vodars is a threat. The two Soviets are tough. Kiro from Cuba might well be the favorite. And down at the bottom, it's good that Yarmila Kraktokvilova, one of the stars of Helsinki, maybe the female star, the 400 and 800-meter winner, made the final eight. For the Americans, zero. Washington, Walton, Floyd, and Clark all unable to hit the time necessary to make it to the final eight. Well, now, the javelin, and it's a most interesting competition. The Finn is still in the lead, we understand, going into the fifth round.
At what might have been the favorite going into this particular competition, Viktor Yevseyukov of the Soviet Union. Very consistent thrower in a very inconsistent event.
This event has given help to the National Football League in a sense. Terry Bradshaw and Russ Francis were both former national high school record holders in the javelin throw. Both powerful players.
With that throw, Yevseyukov takes the lead from the Finn Ratti by 8 inches.
Watch his run up now. 70 to 75 feet he uses to build up the speed, which is so instrumental. The legs are key to this event. It's not so much the upper body. Watch the leg plant of the left leg in the follow through. He makes the whip-like motion, stays behind the plane, doesn't break it.
An excellent throw for Yevseyukov, taking the lead in the fifth round. Not much of this competition left. Let's go back to Charlie Jones.
Thank you, Dwight. And this, of course, the conclusion of the 20-kilometer walk.
Maurizio Damilano pulled away in the last third of the race, and the second Mexican was also disqualified, so it made it a bit easier on him. The Italian comes home. They were singing to him as they saw him come in on the screen. They were singing, whoa, 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 bringing him home, and he just had an easy time the last third of the race. And he's going to run, he's going to walk a little bit over 1 hour and 20 minutes.
So Maurizio Damilano of Italy and all of Rome is celebrating. Let's listen. And finishing second with the silver medal, Jozef Pribilinec of Czechoslovakia. So there you have the gold and the silver, and the celebration continues.
Charlie, I think the Italians were hungry. There's Jose Marin from Spain finishing third.
And the real cheer, the bronze medal. Go ahead.
And the real cheer you hear is for Carlos Mazzioli from Italy, walking a personal record, coming in fourth place.
No, first, no, this, no. Is, most
this is Mostovic.
Mostovic of the Soviet Union is fourth, and they wait for Mazzioli, who is behind him in fifth place. $65,000 here yesterday, over $60,000 today here at Olympic Stadium. And the flags are out, and the celebration has been going on for the last 20 minutes. And there is Mazzioli of Italy joining his teammate, Damilano, who finished first. Mazzioli comes in fifth.
I think the Italians were very hungry for a gold medal. Yesterday, they had a second in the 10,000 meters, a second in the shot put. Both men really favored to win, or among the favorites, but there was disappointment. Now they have their first gold medal of the World Championships.
The celebration continues in Olympic Stadium.
Oh, the call will be strong for vino in the Roman restaurants tonight. Oh, Chianti Classico. Damilano wins the first gold for the Italians. Jozef Pribilinec of Czechoslovakia second, and Jose Marin of Spain was third. Damilano from a little small 500-populated town in northern Italy. His dad, the former mayor, you can bet they're celebrating in the north of Italy tonight. So, appropriately, the hosts are the early leaders in the medal race. With Damilano's gold, they have a gold and a couple of silvers, three medals in the first 2 days of competition. Now we go to the final round, the javelin, and we've got a Soviet, a Finn, a Czech, and an American in a very tough competition. One throw to go in the javelin. Dwight Stones, Larry Rawson down below, and still hopes that the American Petronov with a chance to medal.
Dick, as you said, we're in the final round, and this is Seppo Ratti of Finland, currently second, but he is only in second by 8 inches. This is the moment of truth. And he gives it everything he's got. It's a very good flight. And you can hear from the crowd, Seppo Ratti on the final throw of the competition has moved back into the lead, 274 feet, 1 inch for Ratti.
White, this is reminiscent of what Tiina Lilak did in Helsinki in 83 at the first World Championships, her sixth and final throw. Watch him reach back with a spear, plant it up by his ear. The left knee will be bent slightly. It will act as the brake I've mentioned. He whips the javelin through, the legs plant. Look at the screen.
He got everything that he had into that javelin. He's got to feel good about that. Seppo Ratti of Finland. Tom Petronov, currently in fourth. This is his final attempt, his final chance to crawl into the medals. He was the silver medalist in Helsinki. Petronov goes for it all, but he can see that it's not far enough and steps over the line for an intentional foul.
Notice where it landed off to the right there. It was not, as you were saying, straight down the middle, which you try and do in the javelin.
Disappointing competition for Petronov. I know he was coming in here thinking that he might be able to get back into the medals to set himself up for next year's Olympics. He comes through. He's not pressing at this point. Brings the point right next to the side of his head, but he just gets the foot down and the arm behind. He's not in rhythm. He's not in sync. He already knows that there's no chance, and he steps over. It's a shame for Tom Petronov, but there's always next year.
So Seppo Ratti of Finland, that's been their event through the years. Historically, they have six gold medals, the men in the javelin and the long distance running. And the Finns, who won their only gold in Helsinki in the javelin from Tiina Lilak, get another from Ratti today. The Soviet is second, Zalezhny, the Czechoslovak third, and Petronov, disappointed, just out of the medal picture. Now we're ready for the 100 meters finals, the women and the men. And to set the basis for the women's, let's look at the world record. August 1984, Zurich, Switzerland, just 2 weeks after winning the gold medal in L.A., Evelyn Ashford, a perfect race, perfect conditions, lowers her own 100-meter world record to 10.76. And that's the mark they'll be aiming at here in Rome today. Great to see that world record again. It's a shame she's not on the track in person.
A crowd of 60,000 on hand here at Olympic Stadium, the women's 100 meters final. The world record is 10.76, held by Evelyn Ashford of the United States. In lane one is Pam Marshall of the United States. Diane Williams of the United States is in lane two. Angela Isayenko of Canada is in three. Heike Drechsler of East Germany is in four. She would be the favorite. Merlene Ottey of Jamaica is in five. Silke Gladisch of East Germany is in six. Anaya Nunava of Bulgaria is in seven. And Angela Bailey of Canada is in lane eight. And Missy, Heike Drechsler has looked exceptionally good.
There's a good shot of Heike. She has looked good. Last round, though, she had a bad start. But like you said, she still looked great because she has that top speed, what people talk about Carl Lewis having. She doesn't have a great start, but if she has a decent start, watch out because she's fast.
She will be challenged on her right. Merlene Ottey of Jamaica is in lane five. And Silke Gladisch is in lane six. Silke in lane six, also from East Germany. And everybody feels that Silke may have peaked a week or so ago at the East German National Championships.
She did set her best time there of 10.86, but then we saw 10.82. That was wind dated. But it might be the best starter against the best one that comes on at the end because Silke Gladisch in lane six is very quick out of the blocks. Heike didn't have a good start, but she really comes on the last 20, 30 meters, so it's going to be interesting.
Let's swing over to lanes one and two. Pam Marshall, United States, and Diane Williams, United States. Do they have a chance to medal?
I think so. Diane Williams, of course, had the bronze medal in Helsinki. She's in all white. Pam Marshall's in blue. Pam is a strong runner. She's under 50 seconds for the 400 meters, but she admits, Charlie, she has a ragged start. She's going to have a good start to medal. But Diane Williams has worked on her start a lot. She could medal.
In lane three from Canada is Angela Isayenko, who also, they've all looked good.
Right.
It becomes almost a broken record, but she looked good, particularly in the first round, I thought.
Look at Angela. She's very strong. She's worked on weights a lot. And an interesting note is that Ben Johnson's coach also coaches Angela. And she looked very well indoors, and she looked very good at the heat. And she was closing in on the other women the last 10 meters.
A warm day today again in Rome, but cooling off here in the early part of the evening. Almost ideal conditions for sprinting. Again in lane one is Pam Marshall of the United States. Diane Williams is in lane two. Angela Isayenko of Canada is in three. Heike Drechsler, the favorite from East Germany, is in lane four. Merlene Ottey of Jamaica is in lane five. Silke Gladisch of East Germany is in six. Anaya Nunava of Bulgaria is in seven. And Angela Bailey of Canada is in lane eight.
Heike Drechsler set the championship record at 10.95 in the semifinals, even with a bad start.
Little bit of a weight. This can kind of play on your mind, and so experience comes to the fore here.
I think one thing Heike Drechsler's thinking about is that start. She's changed her start this year. We'll have to watch. It's a little different. It worked for her well yesterday. Today, she looked a little ragged.
It is not a comfortable-looking start.
No, it's not, Charlie. She's so tall, 5'11". She's changed it where she has almost like a coil start. She bends her arms. We'll have to watch that. But it's worked well for her yesterday. Today, had a little bit of a problem with it.
This is the final, women's 100 meters. And the only one missing, of course, is Evelyn Ashford, who is still out with that injury. We talked with Evelyn today, and she's fine and back and in training and be ready for the Olympics in Seoul.
I think she made a smart move, Charlie, because she had a slight injury to her left hamstring, which has bothered her before, but it's not that bad. She thought, why risk it for 88?
Exactly. All right. Now the run for the gold. And it's a fair start. Drexler does not get a good start. Isayenko gets the start. And it is Merlene Ottey. And then outside it is Gladisch. It is Silke Gladisch of East Germany. Silke Gladisch is going to win it. And Drexler may come in second at the lead.
Try, it looks like it could be a championship record that's unofficial, but she had the start.
An unofficial 10.91.
Silke Gladisch on the left of your screen gets a good start. Not quite as well as we saw this morning, but she's out and she stays in good running form. She's got that lean. That's important. She stays relaxed here all the way through the tape. And Heike Drechsler looks like, I think she came in second.
Yes, and Ottey goes for third. And Gladisch is a lean, mean running machine, because I think she's kind of, I think that her feelings had been hurt this week, because she is on the left in lane six. Everybody was talking about Heike Drechsler and Heike this and Heike that. I think that she just decided that she was going to prove it right here, that she had not peaked earlier.
Good power with her arms. She carries them low, gets them down by her hips. Good power, strong legs. Heike just did had such a terrible start. Merlene Ottey is also a tall runner. She came in well the last 10 meters as well. Happy, that's a happy Silke Gladisch right there.
And we'll be back with more of the World Championships from Rome in just a moment.
So the East Germans, who were so powerful, especially the women in Helsinki, won two in the women's 100-meter dash. And oh, you think ahead to the 4x100 relay, are they going to be tough? Gladisch and Drechsler, despite that horrendous start, Drechsler almost catching her teammate. Ottey just nosed out, finishes third for the bronze, and Diane Williams, it's been the story of the United States today, another fourth. Evelyn Ashford, 10.90, the winning time. Let's see, what was the world record again?
Do you think I should know it? 10.76.
And so that is still safe. As you looked at the race, you had picked Gladisch, and with Drexler's start, it looked like you had a winner right off the bat, but she really ripped that final 50 meters.
Drechsler is so tall, I think she has trouble getting her legs going at first. It looks like she's trying something totally different with the start. Starters don't usually bend over that much.
I thought you had a good comment. You said she knows how to run, but she's learning how to race.
Yes, she's learning how to race. She can run fast, but there's a difference between winning fast and racing. And this was a championship race. She doesn't have that experience.
We want you to look at the race again and analyze. Now, that's the winner third in from the outside. And look how far back Drechsler is and how far...
She gave him 15 meters at least. She's coming on right now. She's very strong. Her leg speed is going very well, but Gladisch is just gone. She can't catch her. She gave her too much room in the beginning.
Right, the natural question here are the implications for Seoul as we look at the head-on, and you see how much slower that Drechsler reacts and gets out of the blocks.
Yes. I think she's just having trouble with it for this particular meet. Last year, I don't remember her having that trouble. Gladisch is just gone. She's got tremendous leg speed. The East Germans look very good for next year, and Ottey is running backwards as she usually does.
I mean, she's leaning too
far back.
She's
leaning a little bit too far backwards.
Well, Drechsler came here, and of course, the advanced publicity not in her favor because they were talking about her in the same terms as Carl Lewis in Helsinki, that she could come away with four golds in the 100, 200, and two relays. Now she's down to three races, but still could go home with three golds and a silver.
Oh, she'll certainly do well. And next year, she'll be the one to watch because she is getting the race experience, like I said before. She'll be fine.
Well, let's talk about that then. Now, let's just handicap Seoul from a long distance, a year away. If you had to put the top three women in your crystal ball, how would they place in the Seoul?
Obviously, Ashford is number one, as usual. Drechsler, and I think Gladisch.
So you just looked at the two people you feel are the threat to stop you from a gold.
Right.
Well, it's been a pleasure for you to help us analyze.
Thank you. This has been fun. I enjoyed it.
Well, stick around.
Okay.
We got a lot of other questions during the course of these championships. And we'll return as we build toward the 100 meters for the men, the fastest man alive. And they're shooting for this world record. 15 years ago, Jim Hines set his legendary 9.95 in Mexico City. Then Calvin Smith here, Bolton, Mississippi, finally broke it, running 9.93 in the thin air of the Rockies in Colorado Springs. Calvin Smith, 9.93, the Mark Johnson and Lewis, and six others shoot at today.
The final of the men's 100 meters. This is the one we've been waiting for all day long. The world record is 9.93. That July 3rd, 1983, Calvin Smith. The lane assignments for the finals. Viktor Brezgin of the Soviet Union is in lane one. Pier Francesco Pavoni of Italy is in lane two. Raymond Stewart of Jamaica is in three. Attila Kovacs of Hungary is in four. Five, Ben Johnson of Canada. Six, Carl Lewis of the United States. Seven, Lee McRae of the United States. And eight, Linford Christie of Great Britain.
Charlie, all the teasing and taunting are over. This is it. This is where we find out who the world's fastest human is, and it really will be decided here today. Ben Johnson has beaten Carl Lewis 4 out of the last 5 times they met, but the last time they met, he beat him by 1/100th of a second. It really is that close. If ever there were a time where a world record could be set, and you could find out who is the fastest human in the world at the same time, this is it.
Ben Johnson on the right, number 145 in the red from Canada, and he'll be in lane 5, and Carl Lewis, taking off his sweats on the left, will be in lane 6. Now, just outside of Carl Lewis will be Lee McCrae of the United States, and then Linford Christie of Great Britain. So you have the feeling that the top half of the lane assignments, that's where the power is. Then on the other hand, back in lane 3 is Raymond Stewart of Jamaica.
Raymond Stewart of Jamaica is a real sleeper, but Carl Lewis has to be the favorite. I think the feeling here really is Ben Johnson is the best on paper. He's been running the best recently, and yet people can't quite believe that Carl Lewis can be beaten, even when Ben Johnson beats him. So before, athletes could always say, well, Ben Johnson is really on top of his form. Carl really isn't ready. Carl is ready. He said so. You can see it in the way he ran in the heats. He set another championship record in the semifinal. He's the holder of the meet record in this meet, and yet everyone's saying also, but Ben Johnson is the faster runner. I think it's just too close to call, and the picture's going to tell it all.
Carl Lewis with a 10:05 yesterday, a 10:03 today. And again, if you weren't with us earlier, the black ribbon on his vest in honor of his father who passed away this past spring. So all of the waiting is over. And we're ready now for the final. Men's 100 meters. The very essence of track and field. I love this event. You fire the gun and the man who gets there first is the champion.
And the person out first will most likely be Ben Johnson. He has this new start where he simply kind of hops up on both feet. Carl Lewis has a more traditional start. Here is Carol Lewis, Carl's sister.
And it is a fair start, and it is Ben Johnson who is out. And Ben Johnson is 2 meters of Carl Lewis, and Ben Johnson's going to run away with it. Lewis cannot catch him. Ben Johnson of Canada does it. A 9.84. Unbelievable. You gotta love it. A world record. The wind is okay. Woo! Won it at the start.
Look how much faster he got out. Boom! This is the race coaches are going to show their athletes for the next 50 years. That is the fastest human in history. Carl Lewis, only number 2 now, because Ben Johnson is now better than Carl has ever been.
A 9.84 at sea level.
You can't see this enough. Look how quickly Ben Johnson comes up. He hops up on both feet. And here, where Carl Lewis usually accelerates, Ben Johnson holds him off. Carl closes a little, but he was never going to get him, never in doubt. That is an athlete, and Carl Lewis went to congratulate Ben Johnson, the better athlete on this day, and Carl really showed class by doing this. There is a man who has done what he set out to do. We have a new standard in starts established by Ben Johnson. He pulls his hands up. He hops up on both feet. Boom, look, they both leave the ground, and he's up and running faster than anyone else. He also has the fastest reaction time of anyone in the field, and now he's nearly the fastest in the middle. Carl Lewis cannot catch him. Ben Johnson is the best in history, without a doubt.
Now we'll take another look in slow motion, and you can see it's even more vivid in slow motion as he just explodes. It's a leaping start out of the blocks for Ben Johnson, and the race in reality is over after 20 meters because he has the advantage with the start, and he is so quick, and he has peaked his whole career for today at this moment in time.
He's been a man with a mission. He's had an image to overcome, which is Carl Lewis's. He's very quiet. He's very sedate. He's got a great coach. He just decides what he's going to do. He sets out to do it. And now he's not only the strongest sprinter in the world, he's the fastest. And you can't see it enough. Watch him come up. Look how much quicker he moves. Boom, he's gone. You can see it right there. And that's the race. Now, Carl, I think at this point, thought he might be able to catch him. But look at Ben Johnson's eyes. He is just looking at the finish line.
The overhead view, and just for the record, Johnson, Lewis, Raymond Stewart of Jamaica finishes third, Linford Christie of Great Britain finishes fourth. But the story is Ben Johnson. Let's go down to Dwight Stone.
I'm down here with Carl Lewis. Carl, you told me that you think it's one of the worst races you ever run, but if I'm not mistaken, it's going to be very close to a world record. Talk us through your feelings from the time you came to set.
Well, Dwight, I came to set, I felt very good. But it's a gunshot. I just didn't really come up out of the blocks like I've been doing in the other qualifying rounds. And when you do that in a race like this, you just get left, and that was the difference. I'm really disappointed because my qualifying rounds were going very well, and I was ready to run very fast, and then we came to the final, and I didn't do it. But, hey, you can't take anything away from Ben. He ran a great race. He ran a great time, and he won today.
It seems as though the emotion shifted during the last 2 days from Ben Johnson to you. You became the favorite in the last 2 days. What could you have done differently?
Well, the only thing, like I said, is that I didn't really do what I had to do in the blocks. I mean, Ben has a great start, but I still believe I can come from behind. But I didn't do what I had to do in the blocks, and I got behind with the mistakes, and then I ran very hard to catch up, and then at the end, you just can't do it, so I stayed relaxed.
Was it tough to see him out there in front of you in the lane right next to you? He was almost running on the line next to you.
Well, it was very tough. I mean, especially since the fact that I knew I shouldn't have been that far behind. But like I said, he ran 9:84, whatever the official time is, and it's faster than anyone has ever run. So, you know, he ran a great race. That's the lowdown.
The good news maybe that you got at least an American record
out of
it.
Hopefully, and the one thing we know is that we have the Olympics, and that's my domain.
Absolutely. Back up to the booth and Charlie Jones.
Thank you, Dwight. The world record again, Ben Johnson, 9:84. And we'll be back with more of the World Championships from Rome in just a moment.
From Rome, the World Championships of Track and Field have been brought to you by Jamaican-born Ben Johnson, the hero for Canada, the world's fastest human. Bullet Bob Hayes, who won the Olympics in 64, said, ran like a bullet, ran a perfect race. Here he is now.
Okay, I'm down here with a new world record holder in the 100 meters, Ben Johnson. Ben, a couple weeks ago you said you thought if you ran the perfect race, you can run 9:85. You just ran 9:83.
When I'm pleased with my time, I don't talk bullshit. Whenever I know I'm running, then I tell you if I'm running or not.
You looked like you came out of the blocks very fast as usual, but you came out also very close to the line and then readjusted.
I came out so hard at the blocks. I end up in his lane. And I saw it, and then I back in the middle, I sort of maintain my position and my speed right through.
Did you feel that you really peaked properly for this meet, or is there more in Ben Johnson's legs, a faster time than that?
Well, hopefully next year I'll probably increase my speed and my endurance right to the race. But now I'm pleased with my time and also, you know, world championship man, number one.
Congratulations, world champion, a new world record holder. Back up to Charlie Jones.
And our congratulations to Ben Johnson, the human being. He says it the way that it is. Also, as you know, he's been working on that speech impediment of his, and he has really improved. But what has improved? That, 9:83. Carl Lewis, second, tied the old world record of 9:93. Greatest race in history. Let's go to Dickenberg.
Indeed it was. And Ben Johnson, who has overcome an earlier stuttering problem as a youngster, boy, there wasn't a hiccup in that effort today. 9.83. What a day in Rome. Calvin Lewis runs an incredible 100, 9.93, and finishes a distant second. Stewart of Jamaica third, Stewart of Jamaica is third, and Christie of Great Britain is fourth. Now, as sportscasters and sports writers, selfishly, we all hope to have those great moments to call, whether it be a Super Bowl or a World Series or, in this case today, an incredible world record. We all came to Olympic Stadium today thinking this is going to be something special. And it was one of those rare times when all the pieces fit. And it indeed was all of that. And Charlie Jones, you had the honor, and how exciting it was for you to have a chance to call it.
Great fun, great fun. We look back at Helsinki, and I always think of the 4x100 and that race, and you wondered if here at Rome, if we would have something that would equal that. Well, we had something so much better because Ben Johnson simply devastated the record. I mean, he didn't just take it. I mean, it was a full grasp. And it was, it was one of the greatest races that any of us will ever see, and it was really a pleasure to call it.
And also, you noted as well that when he went on his victory lap, Lewis tried to join him, and he would have nothing of it. I mean, he didn't want to share that moment with Lewis a bit.
No, and I can understand that. I was glad to see Carl come up and give the congratulations. But, you know, there's a great rivalry between those two, and there'll be a lot of confrontations.
I have a sense that we're going to see and hear more from these two men before Seoul in 1988. Well, as we wrap up things here in Rome, we want to also salute another world record, Stefka Kostadinova of Bulgaria, the 22-year-old, 6 feet 10 and a quarter. As we said, that would have won the men's high jump all the way through the Olympics of 1952. And the medal count looks this way as we look ahead to tomorrow night and 12:30, our report. And the Italians have a chance to say, hey, we're at least number two behind the powerful East German team. Soviets have three medals, the USA. A silver for Carl Lewis and John Brenner in the shot put with the bronze yesterday. I guess in some ways a bit disappointing for the American showings thus far.
It's a slow start. But the great thing about it is we've had tremendous events through the first 2 days, and we still have the whole week to go, all ending up next Sunday.
Well, it's been really sharing the gold thus far in Rome in these championship games. They have handed out 8 gold medals, and they've been won by 8 different countries. If you're nationalistic, the United States is not one of those. So on a beautiful Rome day, 90 degrees on the infield, some thought maybe it would soften up the track. Ben Johnson torridly sets a new world record in the 100 meters, and we say goodnight from Rome this evening with a final salute to the fastest human in the world.
Primo e campione del mondo, first and world champion, Roger e Sancho di Londra, Ben Johnson.
Kostadinova, Bulgaria, world record. The Finn continues a great tradition in the javelin. The East Germans, speed to burn, 1 and 2 in the 100 meters. A Jamaican born. We'll have them in that great country to the north of ours. singing, Oh Canada, Ben Johnson, the world's fastest human.